I'll declare this meeting of the committee open. Please note that an audio or visual recording is being taken of this meeting. This means that your presence at and any contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, views disclosed or published publicly by the council, including transferring outside of Australia. And I understand we are again streaming live to the City of Adelaide Facebook page. The council acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pay respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge that they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today, and we also extend that respect to other Aboriginal language groups and other First Nations who are present. I've received no apologies for this meeting. Item 3, confirmation of the minutes. Can I seek a mover and a seconder for that? Thank you, Councillor Sims. Councillor Ho, any discussion? We'll put that to the vote. Those in favour? Those opposed? That item is carried. That takes us to discussion forum items 4.1, the workshop on the city access strategy. And we welcome Mr. Michael Davies from Auracon, who will be joining Shanti, and Clinton is going to preface this item for us.
Through you, Chair. I just wanted to open by saying that the greatest and most livable cities in the world have a clear vision, and that's what helps them arrive at strategies to make their cities great. In Australia, we're in the enviable position of being envied by most of the world for our livability, and particularly Adelaide falls into that basket. We need to change and adapt to remain highly livable and deliver benefits to our community and to the rest of South Australia. And an integrated approach to planning is how we can achieve that. It's fundamental to how we need to look at the city, and it requires collaboration and planning across all three levels of government. Tonight we just share our thinking to date on the city access strategy and what this could look like, and open our minds to the opportunities that presents. So I'll hand you over to Shanti and Michael to present some information to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Clinton. Through the Chair, members, I just want to remind you about the City Access Strategy. It is a project that is being auspiced by the Capital City Committee. We're working as a council with DIPTI to deliver that City Access Strategy, and Auracon are the consultants who are undertaking that work. Members, you'll be aware that in November, Michael presented a pretty high level vision and objectives for this, the strategy as an early starting point. Since they delivered that piece, there has been significant engagement both internally to City of Adelaide staff right across the entire business, as well as with DIPTI staff to sort of try and inform and understand what this piece might look like. But more importantly, the work that Auracon has been involved with has included stakeholder engagement, so with industry groups and the like, to gather their knowledge and evidence around access throughout the city. So the purpose of today is for Michael, without stealing his thunder, is to present the work that has been undertaken since November, to share that with you. But in addition to that, to share with you a set of 5 potential scenarios across the city, which might be options for consideration for access in the city. And I keep reminding both DIPTI and the consultants, Michael might smile and Phil Laws in the back might smile as well, that we can't consider the city as a homogenous landscape. It is different as you move right throughout the city from sort of North Adelaide through the heart of the CBD through to Southern Adelaide and east to west as well. So I'd like to think that whatever scenarios end up being landed on may not necessarily be the scenario that's a one size fits all, and that we might need to look at it in a really cleverly designed, bespoke manner depending on what location one is in. So on that note, thank you, Michael.
Thank you, Shanti, and through the Chair. Thank you for having me back. I'm in better health this time than I was last time, and I'll
to run through a presentation.
Sorry. So you'll recall that we are leading a consultant team that includes InfraPlan amongst another other consultants. We've been appointed to develop city access strategy. We're taking that integrated approach to planning for the transport to support future growth of residents, jobs and visitors to the city. As Shani's mentioned, it's funded by Capital City Committee and being overseen by the department and council. And I acknowledge the contributions that Phil and his team and Shanti and her team have been making to the work that we've been doing today. I came and presented back in November, and with the discussion was really centred on the challenges and the opportunities for transport in the city. And we've been moving on since then. That feedback, that together with the work with the department and council staff, led to some defined challenges and opportunities, which were tested with key stakeholder group in January. And we also tested with them a draft vision and guiding values. And so we've taken on that feedback refined that and presented that to you. So that was circulated effectively as a summary discussion paper with the agenda. But today I really want to focus on the network scenarios that Shanti talked about, which build upon the work that's been done in collecting that data and creating that evidence base for the strategy. So when it comes to the vision itself, succinctly summarised as living, growing, connecting. It is driven by a desire to transform the livability of the city and in turn grow investment. We are trying to clearly articulate that connecting people with an integrated transport system is an enabler of a city that is designed for life rather than the city being driven by a transport outcome. We've also developed some guiding values which represent the broad philosophy that is being guiding the development of the strategy itself. It'll be used to help define the preferred network when we come to that, the objectives, the strategies and the actions that will be incorporated into the strategy. Those values are about people first, a human-centric, safe, inclusive and intuitive movement system. It's equitable, promotes health and well-being and actively fosters community-led change. It's sustainable in that it will reduce emissions and improve the city's environment, helping to mitigate against and adapt to climate change, enabling the city to be resilient and flourish. It will reflect the unique qualities, culture and character of the city's precincts and parklands and support cultural hubs and events. Through precinct connectivity, it will promote livability and stimulate economic growth through purposeful connectivity between the city's precincts, surrounding neighbourhoods and the wider metropolitan area. Innovation is about embracing and adopting disruptive future technology, enhancing asset utilisation, improving performance, offer world-class customer experience. And governance, clear leadership, empowered communities, disrupting the status quo, challenging current norms. And that's all an evidence-based approach. So we're looking at the evidence of current behaviours, challenges, opportunities, and influenced by leading practice from around the world. So when it comes to the work that we've done on the scenarios, what we're trying to do is represent thought-provoking futures that are different from business as usual, as Clinton referred to. They incorporate initiatives that have been explored through case studies to respond to the challenges and the opportunities that were tested with the stakeholders. They are deliberately high level to explore conceptually how the vision may be achieved without discussion being centered on what it means for particular streets. And what we want to explore through the engagement period is just that, what it might mean, and get the communities and stakeholders' views about what they like or don't like about the scenarios. There are a number of assumptions that we've built into the scenarios. So it's consistent with an approach of planning for growth. So consistent with the state government's 30-year plan, consistent with council's aspirations to double the population, grow jobs, which in turn has an impact on the number of people that are visiting the city, increasing the number of trips that are happening daily, and also in line with the carbon neutral approach, we're moving towards a zero emissions transport. We've been deliberate in not considering wildly different scenarios of population growth, jobs, technology, but we acknowledge that those scenarios will have different impacts on those as we go through them. Our approach has been to select five scenarios that generally build on
one another in terms of the interventions and the outcomes, but we've got two outlier scenarios which you could say are the two extremes. The intent of our approach is to enable the different scenarios to be considered, but also the elements of those scenarios to be considered individually. So in effect, what we come to at the end of the assessment process following consultation is a preferred network that incorporates perhaps different elements of each of the scenarios, rather than we've selected a single scenario, as I'll present it to you shortly. Those five scenarios and how and their relationship to business as usual is indicated up here. So we've got the motor city, which is focused on travel by private vehicles. Talk about a destination city that prioritises destination movement and the elimination of through traffic, which is currently nearly 30% of daily vehicle movements in the city. Sustainable city, which significantly shifts the mode of travel to public transport, cycling and walking. Reclaimed city, which reclaims the city for pedestrians and cyclists, and where the car, private vehicle, is a guest in the city space. And the vehicle-free city, which effectively bans private vehicles from entering the city. And I'll run through what those scenarios mean and bring them up conceptually for you in a sec. To build on what Shanti talked about, we recognise that the city is not a homogenous place. And so while we've also been looking at a range of different levers of what these scenarios might mean for streets, for the arterial network that's coming into the city, for the city ring road, public transport, and so forth, we're also considering how the interventions in the scenarios themselves apply differently to different parts of the city, because those areas have different user profiles and different movement patterns. And that's effectively a conceptual representation of Council's spatial vision document. So we come to the fun part, is to talk about the scenarios. Now, we've deliberately represented the scenarios in this fashion to be very conceptual. So it's not a spatially accurate representation of the city street network, because we want to build up and bring it up to that higher level, and that none of those particular lines represent any particular street, although some kind of do correspond to naturally to some, but it's not a direct representation of the network. So the motor city is the first one that I talked about, where it prioritises completely the use of the private vehicle. So wherever possible, road space is converted to traffic lanes, particularly during peak periods. There's a focus on improving access for private vehicles by reducing the road space for other modes. And the connection, therefore, within the city is primarily by vehicle. There are more car parks are required to ensure businesses can successfully grow to compete with suburban car-based shopping centres. And congestion increases, compromising the livability for residents, workers and visitors. So part of the different interventions and different features of that scenario might mean removing bus lanes throughout the city, perhaps reducing the tram network to increase lane capacity, reducing pedestrian crossings to maximise traffic flow, removing bicycle lanes to increase parking, or full grade separation of the city ring road as part of everyone is travelling by vehicle. And we're considering a scenario that's independent of how technology might change for vehicles going forward, but effectively it's private vehicle movement. In the destination city, travel to the city as a destination is prioritised, and so that therefore there's a significant reduction in through traffic. So we are catering for private vehicle travel to the city itself. The reduction of the through traffic, as I talked about before, nearly 30% of daily trips currently, and increasing footpath widths and cycle corridors in some parts of the city, it means a more connected city in key locations. There are growth in businesses in those areas, and there is some improvement in livability for residents, workers, and visitors. We start to have a little bit more of a networked approach, both from a public transport level and from a bicycle network perspective, to allow for through movement, through travel through the city by those modes. But there are interventions made and to discourage that through movement, both either through particular road closures or reducing the speed limit in the city, to discourage cars coming through. But it also requires then an intervention on the city ring route to allow for that traffic to move around. Now, third scenario is the sustainable city, which prioritises sustainable forms of movement to and within the city. Talks about a low emission zone being implemented with an emphasis on active travel, public transport, shared electric vehicles. The reduction of the through traffic that's built on the last scenario and the emphasis on sustainable forms of transport allows for greening of the city, and that improved connectivity and that greening leads to more growth, attraction of businesses and improvement of livability, residents, workers, visitors. In this scenario, we have a much more networked approach to both public transport and cycling that crisscrosses the city and activates and spreads that accessibility further from the current CBD core. In some areas of high activity of pedestrians, there are shared streets implemented more widely, and that scenario still talks about that we're discouraging that through movement, and that is going around onto the city ring road. The reclaimed city has significantly reduced the use of private vehicles in the city, with that space given over to people. It proposes a pedestrian-only area within the CBD core and the rest of the city in North Adelaide divided into super blocks, where cars are circulating on the outside of those blocks and the internal spaces are shared zones with low-speed environments, and those areas are in turn given over to public space, greening, water-sensitive urban design. There's a much broader public transport network that's through the city, including network buses. There's a much bigger network of separated bicycle lanes to go through the city. We're also talking about there the potential for a city tram loop extension to North Adelaide. And if we build on some of the plans that have previously been posited, an underground rail loop through the city. And so that there's a resulting growth and attraction of businesses, clear improvement in livability for residents, which is an attraction, and then therefore workers and visitors to the city. And so much more utilisation again of the ring road as vehicles are effectively discouraged in the city space. And lastly, at our other end of the spectrum from the motor city is the vehicle-free city. Strictly limit vehicle access to essential trips only. So limited goods delivery in the evening and early morning, emergency vehicles, perhaps autonomous taxis for people of limited mobility. The removal of the vehicles needs an introduction of a rapid public transport network which goes much wider right throughout the metropolitan area. It allows for a greening of the city and the intrusion of the parklands in through city streets into the city itself. And that, of course, then results in a different form of growth and attraction of different types of businesses and a dramatic improvement in the livability for residents. So part of that is obviously the vehicles are effectively banned from entering the parklands. They are circulating around the city on the ring road. But also what we're trying to do with this level is building on the last scenario is trying to remove also some other vehicles down off the street level. So potentially you're talking about bus tunnels to remove those vehicles from the streets whilst having the tram loop circulating and potentially up to North Adelaide as well. And again, the underground train as part of the scenario. So five, hopefully provocative, bold scenarios for consideration. And so the next steps for release of those scenarios, which will have a bit more detail, obviously. It's a bit hard to encapsulate all the detail as it means to individual parts of the city, to be released for engagement shortly, which will then, and that will be supported by the release of the summary discussion paper that was circulated with your agenda, which obviously is a much bigger discussion paper that has a lot more detail to it that sits behind that as well. And then we'll come to taking the feedback from stakeholders in the community to do the assessment of those scenarios and develop a preferred network that aligns to the vision and the guiding values. And when that preferred network has been decided, then there's the development of the strategies and actions that would be needed to actually implement that vision. And that would be incorporated to a draft strategy circulated for public consultation. So that's effectively our next steps. I've deliberately tried to keep it high level and brief and allow time for questions and comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. We'll open it up. Councillor Kira.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for the presentation. What have I got to ask? Straight up, guiding values. I didn't see the word efficient there, or efficiency. Is there a reason for that, or is that something you think is assumed? Or?
I think in terms of efficiency of movement, we are more focused perhaps on how people move around rather than the efficient movement or particular types of movement. So if we can go to the guiding values. So we're promoting connectivity, perhaps different types of innovation in movement. But we haven't particularly focused on efficiency as such.
Why wouldn't we want to focus on efficiency if we're planning a future transport network?
The guiding values effectively building on and how to achieve the vision and the movement system being an enabler. But efficiency, certainly we can take that up, the feedback and incorporate.
Thanks. Another thing, just sort of as they came up. You've got a sustainability scenario, and you're mentioning private vehicles in the first scenario. Now, private vehicles, technically, a bicycle is a private vehicle. So can we assume that what you mean by private vehicles is cars? Is that right?
By private vehicles, we are implying a car?
Not bicycles, not private bicycles yet.
No, not bicycles.
Okay. All right. You've got a scenario which is about private vehicles, cars, or whatever. Then you've got a sustainable scenario where you limit private vehicles. Now, sustainability, is that necessarily mutually exclusive with cars? I mean, what happens when cars become electric?
That's one of the considerations as part of that scenario. They're talking about a low emission zone, the cars will go to electric. And we're also mindful that that vehicles in and of themselves have an element of materiality that is needed in the construction and so forth. We're trying to provide some ideas of how people might move more sustainably, noting that yes, electric vehicles might be part of that solution.
Yeah, so when electric vehicles, if cars become electric, that's a sustainable mode of transport, yeah? As far as you're concerned, or do you think that's not correct?
It improves the sustainability of movement, yes, from a current position.
Sure. All right. One more question and then just one final sort of comment. There's a new burgeoning mode of transport, that's e-scooters. I didn't see that garner a mention. Is there a reason for that, or is it something that you think should be or could be incorporated in the future?
Certainly forms of shared micro urban mobility are part of our thinking, and we've certainly considered it as part of our work.
Yeah.
It's a finer grain of detail than
sure.
Cover off on this.
Right. Okay. On that note, and sort of question, perhaps to yourself and perhaps the CEO, I'm not sure what we're supposed to really be doing at this juncture. When I'm sort of presented with what may be a transport or a transport access strategy, what I would hope, and I gather that at this stage we're very high level, but what I think would be useful, and there is one graphic in there about traffic flow and numbers, there's one map, but what would be useful would be some hard data about traffic flow in particular streets, throughput, choke points, that sort of thing, so we as a council can take some steps to actually alleviate traffic bottlenecks. That's the kind of thing that would be useful going forward, but as the CEO, is that, will that be forthcoming down the track in as part of this process, or?
Yeah, through the chair, the intent for tonight was to introduce this topic to you and to gather some feedback on exactly the sorts of issues you've been raising. We will take that on board and work with the consultants to include those considerations when we come back to you. So the process from here is that we will come back to you in committee and we will come back to you in council as the process goes forward. So tonight I encourage you to suggest any inclusions or any issues that you have may need to be included or you may have some concerns with.
Okay, so I suggest. Thanks, Chair. Cheers.
Councillor Sims.
Thanks very much. Thanks for your presentation. Just a question for you about the process in terms of where to from here. So let's wait.
Members, can we?
You just want to ask a question about where to from here. So this has been done in conjunction with the state government. Will, once we get the community feedback, will they need to have buy-in to the strategy? How is the strategy implemented? Where does it go? How does it move from being a high-level document to something that influences the work that we do at a council level?
Through the chair, I might try and answer that question. So as soon as we do have a draft strategy, we will need to seek input from the Capital City Committee. Is very invested in this project, and there is a steering committee that oversees the future of this project. We haven't quite worked out what that next step might be, because one of the things that will need to be developed as a result of the strategy is some actions, and so what those actions might be may depend on what DIPTI is either doing or has in its plans. Similarly, what we as a council might be able to deliver in terms of outcomes from that strategy. So it needs to be a collaborative piece which both DIPTI and council are part of. And when I say that, it may not necessarily end up being high expenditure of funds, or it might be some simple things like involving other people in helping to find solutions for a particular problem. So we're looking at the whole gamut of possibilities to actually deliver something in a long-term sense. So we see this access strategy as not something that's going to be delivered over 1 or 5 years, but potentially over 20 or 30 years.
By way of feedback, I must admit, when we first started this process, I was a little bit cynical perhaps about the benefit of doing a strategy, because I thought, oh, we've done lots of strategy documents. I must say, seeing the scenarios and hearing a bit about the consultation process, I think this is a worthwhile exercise, because giving the community the opportunity to actually envisage what the city will look like, I think is really useful, and would be actually very useful information for us as a council, because often we do have somewhat ideological conflicts around, you know, are we a city of cars, are we a city of bikes, or what balance do we strike? And actually getting some intel from the community about what they see their city being in the future, I think would be very useful. I guess by way of feedback, I also think the options that you've presented are good. Obviously there are some that I'm much more excited about than others. I think the sustainability and reclaiming city sounds exciting to me, but I'd be really interested to hear what the community have to say. So yeah, I think this is a good project. I look forward to hearing the results.
Councillor Knoll.
Yes, also thank you for the report. I'm just intrigued. I mean, we've got the designs from car only to, you know, otherwise alternative only, and we're talking about our little box in the middle of this large city, and we're talking about it without actually having a conversation about the greater Adelaide, which so far, my main interest, and I would think access to Adelaide, requires people to want to come in. So my interest first is of the city, that people that live outside the CBD. And of course, I agree with some of the numbers. Yes, we do expect more and more people to live in the city, because we're building apartments, and that's a fact that happens. But unless we, as the city, then say, what are the attractors? We're talking about increasing employment. Well, what are the reasons, what are the premises of which we actually put that on? Because we're making an assumption, and I can tell you that as the city becomes more expensive, more difficult, there are businesses that are going to exit the city, and there are suburbs. And are we looking at the suburbs as in, certainly I'm talking about the strategy, but I'm talking about what are we basing it on? So we have all these lovely city centres now around ours, that are doing everything they can to be the attractor and the centre of commerce in their areas, but that all detracts from people coming to us. And if we're saying that in our city at the moment we have about 2,000 people per square kilometre, you know, that's a very low number when you compare it to any of our, any of the larger ones, which is Sydney is at 8,000, Auckland is at 12,000 per square kilometre. You're creating your own mass. So that is because of how they're designed. Ours is because we've been able to spread out. So how are we going to, in this exit strategy we have, we're looking at what is that in the feeder suburbs, their developments and their high rises, etc. How are we figuring that aspect? Because as those components rise, and we are about 420 people per square meter kilometer on average over the over our city area, that is well even which other Vancouver or something, they're at 1,000 on average for the city size. It's just that we have this 75 kilometer city, 35 wide. How are we going to make this strategy so that that consolidation, which is what we all want, that movement away from vehicles, which is what we all want, how is that going to be translated into reality rather than just a diagram? Because every time people have an impediment to movement through the city and with the city, they stop coming to the city because there are alternatives and they don't have to come here. So my concern is, who are we looking at the community? How are we seeing that the development of the community and its needs and the infrastructures that sit behind the suppositions? Because unless we are creating an Adelaide city centre-centric viewpoint from the greater, wider, you know, community, which was the case before we had, you know, these urban developments, it's not, you know, those numbers aren't going to pan out, because the more awkward at this minute, and until we have that transition to, you know, driverless cars and not need to, that's my concern, is that transition time. And certainly I agree, buses take 20 years before they get off the roads, you know, cars 5 to 10 years. So there's even those inherent things that dictate how people are going to move until they can move into the next mode of transport that they can afford. So I'm just interested in the development of all those things, because that informs how you can then design the city and how you can map out your growth of that particular design as the need arises. Because if you do it too early, they'll just turn them off and they'll go somewhere else.
Members, any other questions or feedback? Or did you wish to respond to that? Mike?
Thank you, Chair. There's a lot to take in there. Thank you, Councillor McNaught. I think that we are thinking very much of that the city is at the heart of a much larger region. It's connected to a whole range of different centres, and there are big flows of people, and that is expected to increase. The government's plan for growth is to be heavily focused in the inner and middle ring suburbs, of which the city is a key component of that. What we're trying to articulate through the vision is that the changing the nature of the development itself in terms of its development as form is a key driver, and the transport is an enabler of that, and that's the reason why people will be also coming to the city. I'm trying to encapsulate it perhaps in that vision statement, maybe not quite as clearly, but we're certainly taking on all those elements that you talked about.
No further questions?
Okay.
Lord Mayor.
Thank you. Thanks for the presentation. It's a bit hard because we don't have those scenarios in front of us to look at, but they are great provocations. I'm interested that the tram network, particularly the extension of the tram into North Adelaide, only appeared, if I recall properly, in one scenario. I would have thought that tram extension into North Adelaide would have been in at least four of the scenarios. Understanding there's two outliers, so we're not going to go backwards, and it's moving forward from business as usual. I am curious as to the priority of the modes, so that, you know, that ideally the city would cater for all modes of transport, which we currently do, but we actually need to prioritise how those modes work. The super block has come in before, so we've talked about super blocks, but only with relation to our key residential areas, so the southwest, southeast, and possibly North Adelaide. And so the super blocks I've seen play out in other things, and they're actually quite an interesting one. But again, they've only made their way into the outlier, where I would be interested in seeing how you may apply a super block within, you know, something that's not that far out. The other thing is, obviously we have the 3D, as in our 3D planning model, so that we can have a look, which I just grabbed before I walked in, which looks at the developments and the potential developments and what's in our pipeline. And I need to, well, one of the things that we would need to ensure is that it's actually responding to growth in the areas of growth within the central CBD, but also how that connects to North Adelaide and out. I do understand what Councillor Canole was trying to say in terms of we can't look at it as a bubble because we are in the centre of a massive CBD and we need to make sure those connections work. People aren't going to drive up to the edge of the parklands and stop there and then get a second mode of transport unless we do something very, very different. So,
thank you, Lord Mayor. Councillor Don.
Thank you for the presentation. It's great to see the scenarios. What are other cities, other successful cities around the world doing in terms of things like the transport mix and how they're prioritising the hierarchy, as you were mentioning briefly before?
Thank you, Councillor Dunbar, through the Chair. We've looked at a range of different cities nationally, internationally. Some of those are touched on in terms of the summary paper. There are more in the larger discussion paper. The elements that we put into those scenarios are being enacted by different cities all around the world. So whether it's pedestrian-only zones are now being looking to be implemented in places like Leeds, Birmingham in the UK, so Birmingham being a very auto-centric, car-centric city in the UK, to how vehicles might circulate through the city, so there are cities in Europe itself, but Auckland has just released a new plan of how they might circulate vehicles around the CBD core. We are looking at different things, different elements are being picked up. And if I might just touch on the comments of the Lord Mayor about different things are being in different scenarios, we've tried to keep it a fairly broad sweeping scenarios. There are multiple combinations. And I think what we're trying to do through the engagement is then allow for different elements of different areas to potentially be selected so that there might be an element from all of the scenarios that's chosen to come up with the preferred network. And so that the resulting network might be a combination of different initiatives.
And you just mentioned that the more detailed case studies point to this happening around the world where pedestrian zones and access for people who are walking and on bikes are being prioritised. And would that be true also for similar sized cities in the US? Often it's hard for people to picture Europe versus the US. Would that also be true in those locations?
More of these sorts of interventions are happening in cities right across the US. Mm-hmm. The most recent would be in San Francisco, where they have closed Market Street to vehicles.
Mm-hmm. And what about Melbourne and Sydney? There's some local examples. What's happening there for comparison?
So Melbourne has already been making different interventions in terms of its CBD and looking at different initiatives in line with its transport strategy that it released last year. Mm-hmm. Similar sorts of focus on different elements, obviously different spatial applications, but moving to a focus more on pedestrians and cyclists and public transport movement is a feature of cities right across the world.
And why, you've touched on it a little bit, but why is this becoming such a broad range approach that cities around the world that are successful, why are they focusing on pedestrians, people on bikes and public transport? What are the beneficial outcomes that we would expect to apply here in Adelaide if we were to do such a thing?
I think it's probably best summed up by the amount of trips that are expected to increase in terms of the number of people that will be coming to the city. Those trips will increase. We have a limited footprint. We perhaps could expand road space, but that might be an interesting scenario. We've got limited spatial footprint for stuff to occur, and moving more people more efficiently requires a different mix of how people are moving from the current mix, which is heavily favoured towards private vehicles in being cars. Mm.
And often the point comes up around car parking. Based on the number of car parks in Adelaide and comparison to other cities in Australia and other similar sized cities around the world, how would you say we're faring in terms of our number of car parks?
Touched on in the summary paper distributed, but we have more car parks generally than other cities. And we have the most, or the least expensive car parking in the country.
Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure if you have looked at the data, but I believe that we never hit more than 80% utilisation of those car parks. Does that sound about right?
From council's UPark data, about 80%
would be the maximum
capacity.
That we ever hit. Yeah.
Generally during the day, between 20 to 45% capacity within council's UParks.
And for the City of Adelaide, being a capital city, we're very focused not only on our residential wellbeing, but also on, of course, our business wellbeing. So ensuring that whatever transport mix we're looking at is also going to meet the needs of all of our businesses. Based on other cities around the world that have switched their hierarchy and have started to focus on gradually over time improving that focus for people who are walking and people on bikes and for public transport, what are the anticipated outcomes in terms of zones that focus on pedestrians and bikes for retail spend?
So if I use an example of one of our case studies, the implementation of the Strogget in Copenhagen increased retail spend from memory 400% over the course of several years.
400%. And how does that compare? Often I know there's some research that looks at business owners' perception of how people travel to their business versus the reality of how people travel to their business. What could you tell us about that?
I think most recently the Hart Foundation has released some research that suggests that there is a perception that more people travel by car to, and that perhaps more people are actually walking and cycling and using public transport. And certainly if council's own user surveys being capturing a certain segment of people that have been intercepted on the street, there's a greater percentage of people who would walk and cycle and use public transport than, say, general data around them.
So businesses often think that everyone drives and parks up front, but actually that's not the case.
A lot of evidence suggests that that's not the case. Mm.
And what about the data looking at the number of people who are happy to travel by bike without a safe separated bike network versus, I think there's something that says something along the lines of 1% of the population are happy to travel regardless of the conditions, 7% will travel if they have a little bit of infrastructure, and then 60% are happy to travel if they have a safe separated bikeway, and then there's a little bit more than 30% that won't travel under any circumstances by bike. Does that sound about right?
I wouldn't comment on the exact numbers, but general, as a general rule, providing safe infrastructure for people to cycle encourages people who wouldn't ordinarily take up cycling as a mode.
And have you looked at the numbers of people who are moving around the city on foot, by bike, by car at this stage of the work that you've done?
We've been layering up how many people are travelling to the city. Mm. It's very difficult to get a sense of how people are actually moving around. We're looking at some different data sources for how we might understand that, but we're also looking at things like the data from the e-scooters and the trial to understand how people are moving around. And so the average distance that people use an e-scooter for is about 1.7 kilometres, which is a reasonable trip.
Mm-hmm. And I just supplement that answer. We are looking at potential other data sources through DIPTI to help inform that in a more fulsome way.
Okay. So based on the existing numbers, if we were to provide a better network of safe separated bikeways and of course better pedestrian zones, we could safely anticipate that we would be able to take a number of people who are currently sitting in their cars off the road, so decrease that congestion to enable people who do want to and need to drive to be able to find the car parks that they want on the street.
The provision of safe cycling infrastructure increases the number of cyclists, whether they've come directly from a car or they might have come from another mode, but generally that's true.
And just finally, the next item on our agenda happens to also relate to transport, and we are looking at where to put our east-west bikeway. Have you, through the work that you've done as of yet, looked at the different east-west corridors and where it might naturally pop out that you would think within the planning that you're doing the first highest priority for an east-west would be located?
We haven't specifically gone to that level of detail of looking at the solutions. Mm-hmm. We've been building on existing work, which includes that there is an east-west bikeway, mm-hmm. and our scenarios represent that. But not specifically defining where exactly that is.
Which street? Is there anything on the different east-west options that you're aware of? Is there anything that would specifically deter the idea of a bikeway going along any of those streets, based on what you've looked at so far?
I think that the paper that council has prepared, council staff have prepared for the next item, cover off on a number of those issues.
Thank you. I'm just conscious we have three more speakers. Councillor Kouros, Councillor Canolan, and the Lord Mayor.
Thank you. I think Councillor Donovan should run the presentation. Thank you for all that. Just very simply, my concern is, I love to have a balance of the city. I love to have it balancing for cars, for people on bikes, people that love to walk. That would be a dream, but it just seems to be that it's either one option or that option or that option. I would love to see a balance of everything. I just don't see, Adelaide actually being a carless city as yet, but this is a 2030 year plan. My concern is stopping people from coming into the city or not making it easy for people to come into the city. Their cars drives them out to the outer suburbs, like to Westfield or to the Burnside or to other places in which they can take their car and shop, which limits people coming to the city. And also the stats you're telling me that only 80% of the new cars are being used tells me that that's probably already happening anyway. So we're wanting to encourage people to have the city as a destination for them to come in with their cars. I'm not discriminating people with cars, I'm not discriminating people with bikes, but all modes of transport to be able to be used efficiently. And for technology is always changing as well. You know, we're going to be having electric cars, hybrid cars. That's taking into account sustainability. So all of these things are changing. And to say that we're going to be one way and comparing our state or our city with not that much of a population to other cities with very big populations, massive growths, that had to accommodate or change their city strategy to accommodate all of that. I don't think that we're there yet. I think we've got a lot more other things to actually worry about presently, for businesses and for the growth of our city, making it a destination. But I think it's great that we have this. I'm not saying that it's not a great thing. It's fantastic that we look towards the future. But we have to be very mindful that we don't want to kill our city and make it a place where people don't feel welcome, whether it's a car, whether it's a dead bike, whether it's to walk, whether it's, you know, whatever it is, because we need that. We need this growth.
Councillor Noel?
Just following on, because I mean, we're designing this for the community, so therefore, if the community adopt it and obviously take it on, then they will use the city and all the rest. So, and my question is again a thought process. I mean, we have certain. I assume there are certain triggers in the concept for these designs, because if the way our city is designed now, we have a very low population per square kilometre, and you need certain concentrations. I was at luncheon today where you know, from C-Link, CEO Clint Feuerhide. He spoke and talked about the public transport system, and he was talking about it in the sense of trying to get it down to 5 minutes. So obviously these things are triggers, but those triggers are only economic once you bring the population together to be able to create that value so that they're making it economic. But right now buses cost $150 a trip to run, and they don't, you know, and only 20% is funded. In other words, so what are the triggers we use? What assumptions that you're working on? Because if you talk about Copenhagen, well, Copenhagen has 600,000 people in the city, in the city centre. That's, 7,000 per square kilometre. We have 2,400. They have bikes because the cars cost twice, three times as much as ours. So there is a definite trigger that the government has put in place to limit those sort of things. So it's not just about the design. It's all good. It's not a problem. My problem is we have a unique set of circumstances here, and I just want to make sure that in our thought process, we look at we as Adelaideans, and we make things that are then work better. Because if we have a mix, and we talk about cycling, the thing, the thought process there, you have to be able to cycle, but when the weather is not right and the circumstances are right, well, how are we, you know, bringing the public transport into that, and then occasionally a vehicle into that as well, because that's the three modes you need if you're going to try to divest yourself of particular. So how are we thinking of that, and in that span of 10 kilometers around the city, how are we able to make that network work in those, across those areas?
Thanks. Question.
Thank you, Franz. Lord Mayor.
Yes. What are the triggers?
Sorry, so you're answering that question.
I don't know, Councillor Miranda, do you have a question?
I just had a question on the...
In order, the Lord Mayor, then we'll go to Rob and then myself.
Sorry, I was just waiting. Michael looked like he was about to answer the question. So before I...
Oh, if there was a response from Michael. Michael.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. I just a comment on issues of triggers and part of the particular strategies. It's our approach, our work to do after the scenarios have been part of the engagement. So where do we want to land the vision, and what are then the strategies that you have to consider? What would be the triggers and what would have to happen? We'd also be doing that assessment of what does it mean for livability, what does it mean for business, what does it mean for visitors, so that assessment process will consider some of those other aspects there.
Thank you. Lord Mayor.
Thank you. Sorry, I was just going to ask, so the next stage we're going to consultation, what form is that consultation going to take, and how are people going to be able to respond? So for instance, as they go, well, the sustainable model looks great, but where's the tram that goes to North Adelaide, or, you know, how are they going to respond? Otherwise, you've got five scenarios. Are they just responding to each scenario, or are they responding to various points?
We're still developing and finalising the exact approach to engagement, but each of the scenarios will have developed different initiatives and outcomes that are explained as to what it means for the CBD core, what does it mean for the frame, the residential neighbourhoods, for main streets, what does it mean in the parklands. And it's those different elements that people could consider and say, I like that, and that's part of what we've tried to conceptually represent in the diagram that's on the screen, is that I like this bit of what it means here, but also that they provide comments of I like this element from this scenario. The exact form of that and how that occurs, but that's certainly the intent, is that we can get to a point where we can have feedback that will inform how we select the preferred scenario.
Councillor Martin.
A quick question. First for the CEO, is it the intention of this meeting to influence the consultation that follows? Is that what we're doing? We're feeding into it?
I think we're being consulted ourselves. And I think it's been made clear that these scenarios will go out in public consultation.
So we're determining what's on the table and off the table?
No.
We have no
idea. This is our consultation.
Do we decide what?
So we don't have any influence.
So they're saying no.
They're seeking feedback, but Michael, is this going to influence what you put out to consultation?
I can't be interested.
No, not at this point in time.
So we're also going to be debating something over which we have no influence. Okay.
Councillor, I don't think we're debating, we're just giving feedback. Did you have feedback or a question?
Well, my feedback is it seems like an extraordinary waste of an hour to be feeding back things over which we have no influence, whatever. It's extraordinary.
Councillor Sims. Then Councillor Moran.
Look, it's actually just a response to some of the concerns that have been raised by members around some of the scenarios. And I guess just to remind people that, of course, technology is changing. And, you know, just because we might be a very car-centric city at the moment doesn't mean that in 20 or 30 years' time we're going to be, and people will be using transport in very different ways. So to me, it makes sense to look at you know, how technology is changing and to talk to the community about the kind of vision they would like for our city. So it's in that spirit that I think we should approach it, rather than being locked into a discussion about what the current modes of transport are, because as we've already heard, Adelaide is at the moment a very car-centric city. It has a proliferation of car parking, you know, but that's not, I would hope, the direction that we'll be in the next 20 or 30 years, because changes are happening the world over in terms of transport.
Councillor Moran.
Yes, just what gave birth to this? I mean, we've had smart moves. We're not being, I hear that we're not being asked to, we're not being consulted over this, which is usually what we are, so that if the feed in, I'm rather glad listening to some of the troglodyte views here that we're not actually being asked, and that this goes out unchanged. But what part has have councillors had in this? Was there a motion moved? I mean, we spent hundreds of boring hours doing smart moves. This seems like a very junior, you know, very starting at ground level again. Shanti?
Through the chair, as I indicated when we at the beginning of the session, this project has been driven by the Capital City Committee. So this is a Capital City Committee auspiced project. Mm-hmm. And so Oricon are undertaking this project on behalf of the Capital City Committee.
So what's our input into what's in here? Nothing. So these questions we might as well really not answer, because nothing we say. What if we all, for instance, said we hate bikes? Taking an extreme thing. We hate bikes, we only like cars, hate public transport, we don't like any of it. It would mean nothing, or the thing. So it just seems that it's pretty, I don't want to sound jaded, but what is, you could have just given this to us to read. We didn't really, the information back is going nowhere, is it? And while I'm rather glad this is some of the speakers, I think that it seems a bit, what are we here for?
Is that a rhetorical question, Councillor?
Well, it's not a rhetorical question. Why could we not just have read this? Because all the views that have been given feed into nothing. You were just like Joe Blow that will feed into consultation.
Councillor, I don't think that's right. Michael, are you taking on board this feedback?
No, you can't take on board the feedback. I can't, we forbid it. We can't, we cannot, without a vote, direct the staff. That was made very clear.
Councillor, this is a workshop.
No. They've just said, explain to you, Chair, that this, we are only being told what is going out. We have no effect on what's going out, unless I misunderstood that.
CEO, did you wish to?
Through the Chair, just to be really clear.
I'm happy with that. But
the intent tonight was really for the consultants to work you through the content of the paper that's been prepared so that you are fully aware of what the process is and what it contains. The comments you've made are useful because they inform our discussion. You will be provided a good opportunity once this process has progressed, with the consultants will come back to you with a gathering of the information that they've been able to pull together. And at that time, you'll have a detailed conversation and you'll be in committee where you can debate, where you can debate and determine your position as a council. So there is a process that we're going through. This is just an early heads up for you to understand what is going on, who the consultants are, and the process they're going through.
Okay, but I think that's been misunderstood by people who have given their views. So our view, however our discussions, like for instance, France has given a very detailed view of what he sees the world as, how has that been helpful?
It's been helpful because you've been able to have a conversation about topics that you're interested in. As we progress, you'll become more informed when you are required to make a decision, you'll make an informed decision.
You do see what I'm talking about. If it's just to inform us what is going out to the public, and nothing we say will alter what's going out to the public, why couldn't you just let us read it?
The judgment call was that you would benefit from...
Tell you what, I would rather do anything else than...
Councillor, please direct your remarks through the chair and speak respectfully.
I am saying exactly to you. I think that we could have read this perhaps a little bit more detail at our leisure rather than sit here when we've got lots
of reports. It's a judgment call that this is a $300,000 study or strategy that we're commissioning,
sure.
And this is our opportunity. This is our opportunity to be updated as to what's happening.
It does.
That's exactly what's happened. Are there any further questions of the speaker or of the content?
I've got a question of
Councillor Kouros, Councillor Martin, then Councillor Kira.
So as I understand, going back to what Councillor Moran is saying, this is devised by the Capital City Committee. You're asking feedback from us, City of Adelaide, DIPTI are providing their feedback. But are you also also speaking to local businesses as well? Is that because you said that you're speaking to stakeholders, industry groups, but are you going actually on ground and speaking to businesses?
For the Chair, we have business groups and precinct associations, a part of our stakeholder group who were consulted in January.
Councillor Martin, then. Councillor Kouros, did you have a further question? Councillor Martin.
Through you, Chair, to the CEO, is it a correct conclusion that this consultation will go out to the public, setting out a series of options for the future city access arrangements for the City of Adelaide without having had any vote or input from the elected members of the City of Adelaide?
I think we've already had...
No, that's a very specific question.
CEO.
Chair.
Freudian slip.
Sorry about that.
He's ambitious.
The project is being undertaken by consultants who have been engaged by the Capital City Committee. Those consultants are doing their work. They are progressing the project. And when they have progressed to a point where they can provide some conclusions for you, they'll report back to council. That is the process.
Councillor Kira.
That was my question, but I'll just add to that question.
Councillor Martin, please let Jesse speak.
So we cannot shape the public consultation anyway. Is that because we have delegated the entirety of the public consultation to the third party provider, or was it to the Capital City Committee? Can you explain why it is? I think there's some discomfort here that there's a public consultation we've been presented with it, but it is effectively going to have one way or another, politically, this is going to have our imprimatur. It's going to be read as something the council's put out and deliberated on, but it seems that we can't actually shape it in any way. Can you quell that discomfort? Explain why that is.
Through the chair, I can only go back to the intent of the Capital City Committee was to engage consultants to undertake an independent analysis of this topic, to consult with a range of key parties and to provide that information back to council, back to the government through the Capital City Committee. You will, as a council, have the ability to consider the outcome of that process and determine your response. That's the process that's being laid out.
We do have to.
Lord Mayor, did you have anything to add? No. Councillor Simpson.
Look, I don't want to keep labouring the point, but I do think Councillor Moran has raised an important point about this process. It's not particular to this particular project which I'm supportive of, but I do think it highlights a problem with this new structure. And
Councillor Sims, this workshop is being conducted the same way that every workshop in the last 5 years. Councillor Sims, Councillor,
just finishing my point.
No, I'm clarifying for you that this workshop is being conducted the same way the original workshop on the old rules was conducted when Michael came in here last time. It's the same way that workshops have been conducted in this room for the last 5 years.
I do think there is still some unanswered questions about the new process.
Councillor Martin.
Could the administration cease describing these meetings as committee and call them encounter groups?
I'll take that as a comment.
Thank you.
Members? Not so fast, Michael. There being no speakers, I actually wish to ask some questions now, over an hour later. Thank you for the presentation. We'll make some comments on it and the next steps, outlining that we're actually at the beginning of a considerable process. But I'm just wondering, when you're talking about who you've consulted, and I know that you've said you consulted precinct groups and resident groups, who else have you consulted? Can you give us an idea of those stakeholders there and about how many of them?
Thank you, Chair. We did have about 60 odd stakeholders who were invited to a workshop. Not all could attend in January. The exact number was in about the 28 attendees from memory. That included industry groups, so groups like the Property Council, UDIA, Planning Institute, Transport Planners Association, the like. It included precinct groups, it included resident groups. In the city, it included organisations like Business SA, RAA, so a wide stakeholder group were at least invited, not all could attend, and then all were distributed some information after the workshop.
And so groups such as Business SA, UDIA, Property Council, etc., they were invited. Were those particular groups, did they attend? I'm specifically honing in on property owners and businesses.
Some precinct business groups attended. The Property Council were unable to attend.
Did Property Council or Business SA attend? Did they provide feedback if they didn't attend?
They haven't specifically provided feedback on the information that was circulated to them post the workshop.
And was there an alternative date offered for those people that couldn't come to the original workshop?
We didn't offer an alternative date, but we did offer the ability to contact us directly.
Did Walking SA and Bicycle SA, did they attend the workshop that you held?
Yes.
Another couple of questions. So that just gives me an idea of sort of what's coloured it. Coloured what we've got in front of us today. If I could just have silence, please, members. When I look at this, I love the blue sky thinking. I think it's good, and I think governments generally don't do enough blue sky thinking. I want to know what sort of things you've looked at existing, because this looks like a complete blank page, and you've gone out. Not necessarily consulted everyone, but that's not the end of the world at this point, and come up with some scenarios looking at what other cities in the world do. How much have you looked at, and I think this carries on sort of from what Franz was saying, existing initiatives, both by the city and the state government, investing in the infrastructure that we've got at the moment. So I note in the report we've got road spending in total and cycling as a percentage of that in there. But I'm more interested, so we've got $569 million spent on roads, we've got $4 million spent on cycling. Where is that $565 million on actual road spending going? Is that going in the city? Is that going around the city? Have you looked at that number yet?
For that particular figure, that's a statewide figure, rather than a specific for the city itself. We have been looking at the different initiatives, and that's been incorporated into the thinking and the analysis that we've been doing.
Have you been engaging with our traffic teams at all around the current way that lights are sequenced in the city, and whether or not there are efficiencies there, whether or not they're sequenced in a particular way to already disadvantage particular flows of traffic in favour of others?
We have engaged with a broad group of staff from council, but we haven't gone to that level of solutionising at this point in time.
I guess I'll just give some feedback briefly and then we'll move on because I'm conscious of time. But I suppose on this, like I said, I do like the blue sky thinking, but it's almost too blue sky in a sense, because we're sort of just lobbing this out there based on a few assumptions, which from what I can tell, and maybe they're the correct assumptions, maybe they're not, I don't know, because we haven't actually got the data in front of us at the moment. This is the issue that I've got, is that we're putting forward some scenarios, and as has been highlighted, the answer is probably between them all somewhere. But you're seeking people's community feedback on something that has very, very little detail in it, and that makes me uncomfortable. Not because I don't want to hear from the community, but because I'm just worried that we go out onto consultation on everything, absolutely everything. And you need to make sure that consultation is useful. Otherwise, without providing people with the context and an actual concept to consult on, you know, you could have people coming back and saying, I want to be a reclaimed city because I want to ride my unicorn around or something like that. Like, what I'm saying is people need to be asked a question or a series of questions. And I just don't think there's enough detail in there, or I just worry that there's not enough detail for the answers you get to the consultation to be useful. That's my concern. When I think about city access strategy, I actually started out the opposite to Councillor Sims. I had very high hopes, and now I'm becoming a little bit cynical. Because when I think of the city access strategy, I'm thinking of you working with the state of play as it is at the moment and saying, how can we make this better for everyone who uses the roads? And certainly there can be some targeted outcomes in that, and that might be getting more people onto bikes, that might be getting more people into electric vehicles, onto public transport, and what have you. But I note that we've got in front of us this idea that's lobbed out there that we should be getting rid of car parking in favour of bicycle parking. And that sort of thing, but there isn't the data there necessarily to back it up. And then when we're talking about roads data, we're given what we're spending on cycling, but we haven't been given detail around how pretty much all of the roads spending in metropolitan Adelaide is targeted towards getting people in and out of the city quicker. I'm talking about tens of millions of dollars being spent on McGill Road, Portrush Road intersection, tens of millions of dollars at the Springbank, Dawes and Goodwood Road intersection, tens of millions of dollars, well, probably about $300 million spent between two level crossings on key north-south arterials in the southern suburbs. And then the Crossroad Fullerton Road intersection as well as other projects and Main North Road. So we're looking at hundreds of millions of dollars worth of expenditure there, all geared at getting people in their vehicle to and from the city better. And I'm just concerned that this has a very singular lens that it looks at the city through and doesn't take into account the existing things that are already happening. Now, if you had been given a brief to redesign all of metropolitan Adelaide and you were going to have tens of billions of dollars to spend, I would say, go for your life, start with a blank page and give us the best option. That's not the case. And so I think the way that this will be most useful is identifying the lowest hanging fruit, the most cost-effective projects that can deliver the highest gain. And I'm not preempting what that might be, but I am saying that in your report, you're saying car use is growing, but we should be focusing on bikes. And I understand there is a mix of views around the table, and I know that there'll be a mix of views in the community around that. But what I'm saying is I don't think the access strategy necessarily has the imprimatur to buck the trend and completely rethink how people are using Adelaide. That's my feedback, I guess, at the moment. The only reason I talk in such detail on it is because I'm worried that this might just be another study that gets shelved if the outcome that comes back is not necessarily achievable, and it's costing the city and the state government a fair amount of money, and so I want to see it come back with the best option. I think that means quite significantly looking at the data. I think that means gathering data from a number of sources. I know there are groups in the city that you might wish to work with. Obviously, Business SA. and Property Council. I think their views are integral. And I would just note that based on who you've consulted the cycling lobby and the walking lobby, but haven't consulted the businesses, and that's perhaps their fault for not turning up, but they haven't been given the opportunity to submit to this yet. So I would just encourage you as well to work with groups such as the Rundlemore Management Authority, who have people come, they're a subsidiary of ours, so you should be accessible to them, or vice versa. And also, it's a suggestion, councillor, of where one might look to find. So those are suggestions of where you might find useful data that can inform movement in the city. And as well, obviously you can buy data, but I'd encourage also looking at public transport. DIPTI has a wealth of data with their metro card system, and that's also another useful place to look. But that's my feedback for the moment, and thank you for coming along. We look forward to what the community brings back to us next time. Members, we're now moving on to item 4.2, the workshop on the east-west bikeway, Puri and Weymouth Street. And I understand we have Shanti and Anna. Welcome. Now, very conscious of time, so if you can just bear that in mind throughout the presentation.
Through the chair, purpose of this workshop is to respond to a motion of council asking staff to understand and look at an east-west bikeway corridor, particularly Puri Weymouth Street. So Anna and staff have been working on understanding what that might mean for this particular corridor. Material was sent through to members yesterday and supplemented as well with material that previous council considered in respect of a potential corridor on Flinders Franklin. So we thought it important to share that information with members so that you have a full picture of what's happened historically. Anna's documented the seven or so decisions of council pertaining to bikeways in the city, and so hopefully that helps you to understand I guess the lengthy period of time over which this council has been considering the subject of separated bikeways in the city. Of note too is the fact that we do have a funding deed with DIPTI, which talks about a separated bikeway, and there's $5.5 million combined, half of which is council's contribution, half of which is DIPTI's contribution, and we have received notification from DIPTI that money needs to be spent. To be expended by 30th of June 2021. So we are working on a fairly limited time frame as well, and I'll hand over to Anna.
Thank you, Shanti. So Shanti just said we are responding to a motion on notice, asking us to look at a concept design for the Puri Weymouth Street corridor. So this presentation will just look at some of the considerations that we'll need to look at if we are to design that concept. So the Puri Weymouth corridor is approximately 20 metres wide in between the buildings and about 13 metres wide in between curbs. So the existing layout obviously includes a footpath, on-street parking, line-marked bike lanes and traffic lanes. And just to note that those dimensions of the traffic, parking and bike lanes are all at their absolute minimum width at the moment that they can be. So obviously, if separated bike lanes are to be installed in this street corridor, then space will need to be reallocated from somewhere else. And that would either be the footpaths, the on-street parking, or the traffic lanes. So if we're going to look at reallocating space from the footpath, then there's obviously a few things that we'd need to look at. Obviously, we've got very high volumes of people walking along the footpaths along this corridor. There's a lot of outdoor dining on the footpath, and that seems to be a growing trend. There's a lot more cafes and restaurants appearing along this street corridor. So this combination of high volumes of people and the outdoor dining leads to a lot of crowding on footpaths, particularly at peak times, at lunch times in particular. There's also a lot of existing infrastructure in the footpath, so things like light poles, traffic signals, our stormwater system, some columns supporting buildings. So if we were to kind of reduce the width of the footpath, we would need to relocate some of this infrastructure, and that can get very costly. So due to these constraints, we've considered that this option is not feasible, and therefore we've discounted it from our further analysis. If we were to look at relocating on-street parking space, there are again a few things we'd need to consider. So we would need to remove all the on-street parking along this corridor, which is around 335 vehicle spaces and 60 motorbike spaces. That obviously would have an impact to council revenue of around $750,000 a year. We may be able to look at putting in some on-street parking or loading spaces in some of the side streets. Things like the size of trucks and delivery vehicles would need to be considered when we're looking at access into those areas. There's also a couple of uses, so the parklet outside the Chibo Cafe and some landscaped areas on Weymouth Street that are using the curbside space that would also need to be removed if we were to utilise that curbside space for a light park. But just having a quick look at an indicative cross-section, if we were to put in a bikeway by removing on-street parking, the cross-section would look, we'd have footpaths as we have at the moment, there'd be bike lanes adjacent to the curb, there would be two separation strips which would be there to protect the bike riders from cars but also allow people somewhere to wait when they're trying to cross the street, noting that they'd have two bike lanes to cross as well as two traffic lanes. And there'd be one traffic lane in each direction. So if you look at reallocating space from traffic lanes, obviously we've got two-way movement along Piri Weymouth Street at the moment, and the existing traffic network within the city is kind of built up around that and uses that. There's a lot of off-street car parks that are accessed either directly from the Piri Weymouth corridor or from side streets off it. And there's currently some localized congestion that occurs at peak times, partly a result of access and egress to those car parks. It's obviously possible to have one-way traffic in this street, but we wouldn't consider it advisable unless we did a broader assessment of the impacts to the wider street network and accessibility. And it may mean that we might need to tweak some other intersections or streets as well to accommodate the fact that this street could be one-way. So again, just looking at an indicative street cross-section, if this were the street were to be made one-way, again, we'd have footpaths that would be the same width as existing, bike lanes adjacent to the curb, with separation strips there again to protect bike riders from opening car doors, and also again to allow people to cross the street. And then obviously be one traffic lane in each direction, and an on-street parking lane as well. There are also a series of further design considerations that we'd need to look at, and I won't go into detail here because they were all outlined in the agenda papers. But just quickly, the West Terrace Weymouth Street intersection would need to have traffic signals on it there. There are 10 traffic lanes there that we would need to cross to get people on bikes safely across to the shared path on West Terrace. Light Square and High Marsh Square would need some adjustments to make them safe for bike riders. And the Weymouth Street widened footpaths obviously would impact on the street widths that we have available to implement separated bike lanes. We have a couple of key questions for feedback.
Excellent, thank you, Anna. Councillor Martin.
A question for the administration. Will anything any elected member has to say in response to those questions influence the administration in respect of this proposed bikeway? And if not, what is the first opportunity for elected members to have any influence over this outcome?
CEO.
Through the chair, the resolution of council back in April 2019 required that we prepare bikeway concept designs pretty much related to Piri Weymouth Street. We're in the process of working that work up. The intent tonight was to brief you on our progress and brief you on some of the opportunities and challenges with that work. The intent will be following tonight, following the conversation that you may or may not have tonight, the administration is going to finalise a report. That report will go to committee and then the report will then forward on to the next council meeting. Maybe I'll be qualified, not maybe the next council meeting, I'll check on the workload of the staff, but the intent will go to a council meeting. At the council meeting, that's when council will debate and resolve upon a decision.
And so if, as a, for instance, I were to make a suggestion to the administration about how we might achieve this outcome, it would have no impact.
Through the chair, as I stated earlier, we've been having these workshop sessions for 5 years, maybe more. The sessions have been productive. They've enabled council members to become informed, to provide information to staff, and for staff to work productively towards a constructive outcome. I don't see how that's changed in any way in recent times. The intent is to allow you to have a conversation, for that conversation to be productive. The staff are certainly learning and researching and taking on board comments, and those comments will inform how we prepare our report. It's not a decision-making process, it's an information-gathering process, which I think is entirely appropriate.
So,
Councillor, do you have questions related to the contents of the report?
A question of the CEO.
Is it related to the contents of the report?
Yes.
Or is it related to procedurally how we operate?
It's allowed to ask procedurally.
It's one or the other.
Well,
it's one or the other, and I do not wish to deprive members of the opportunity to interrogate this topic when you can ask questions of the CEO on your own time.
Look, I'm sorry, Deputy Lord Mayor, but which part of the standing orders are you referring to in declining my questions?
I didn't say I was declining your question. I asked what it was related to before I declined.
No, you made clear that you'd only accept one kind of question. Which part of standing orders are you referring to?
I'm not going to answer that question right now, Councillor Martin. We are dealing with the topic in front of us. Councillor Sims has his hand up. You're depriving your fellow councillor of the opportunity to ask a question or give feedback on the matter before us. Is your question related to the two questions in front of us or the contents of the report that's been distributed?
No, I won't ask a question. I'll offer some comments.
Please.
Thank you. Taking note of the CEO's remarks, that the comments of elected members would inform staff decisions in preparation of a report that is to come to council. I must say that I am appalled that this matter is back in the hands of the elected body, having made a clear decision in 2016 that an east-west bikeway would be located on Flinders Franklin. That decision was disputed in 2017 on the basis of a petition signed by several dozen people, curiously from the same address in Flinders Street, and led to the proposal that Piri Weymouth should be investigated.
So, Councillor, I think there's a key governance issue there that's being missed. Councillor Rudy, it's my understanding that there was a motion or notice to put on hold the east-west bikeway discussion. Is that the case? If so, that's been a key thing that's been missed here in the council's remarks.
Look, hang on, Deputy Lord Mayor, you're entering the debate.
No, we are not debating, Councillor. I'm trying to clarify your statement, which missed a crucial step that's brought us to where we are today.
All right, well, let me address precisely the point that you're seeking to make.
Please, if you could clarify your remarks.
The then leader of Team Adelaide, your predecessor, Hassan Abiad, brought to the elected body a motion that was designed to put on hold Flinders Franklin to investigate Piri Weymouth on the basis...
That is incorrect, Councillor. There was a motion brought in the last term of council that effectively put on hold. In fact, I think those were the exact words used, and it was seconded by Councillor Moran, put on hold the east-west bikeway. That's what's brought us to where we are today. Yes, there was a motion put by the former Deputy Lord Mayor to look at Piri Weymouth, and that's what's brought us specifically to this option.
But
it was not that motion which stalled the process in the first place.
I thank you.
Can I move these motions as well?
So we could look at Piri.
No, Councillor Antic moved the original motion to put the east-west on hold, and you seconded it, Councillor Moran.
I'm quite happy to admit that. That was because so we could use our funds to complete Frome Road.
Look, hang on. This is a procedural matter. Do you want to talk about procedural matters or do you want to talk about the substance?
I wish you to clarify and make accurate remarks, Councillor. I do not wish to have other members misled.
An entirely accurate narrative. What the procedures were is incidental. The simple fact is that Council had agreed that Flinders Franklin was the preferred option, and that was subsequently suspended in favour of an investigation at Piri Weymouth. That Piri Weymouth route was by the administration ruled as least desirable of a range of options, which included, by the way, Deputy Lord Mayor, and I know that you've been speaking to media today, which included a proposed route that took in Grote Street across the road to what's it called? Wakefield, that's the word I want, thank you. So we are revisiting ground that the previous council went over many, many times. This is a dud option. It is an absolute dud option. There is only one option. It always was, it always will be Flinders Franklin. And any attempt to suggest alternatives is merely an attempt to delay an east-west bikeway. We have the money from the state government. We have almost $3 million to contribute to this project. We have a commitment of the previous council and this council, through its strategic plan, to complete the east-west bikeway. Any delay in this is simply, in my view, a means of putting at risk that state government money, having Franz's son or...
I'll need a show of hands for Councillor Martin to continue. Councillor, please have respect. You're referring to him as Councillor Noel Franz.
Now, hang on.
I need a show of hands for Philip to continue. Do I have those show of hands?
No, but hang on, there's no voting in there.
The speaking procedures still apply, time limits still apply, show of hands for extensions of time to speak still apply. Can I have a show of hands, please? There is not a majority there.
Hang on, yes there was.
No, there wasn't, Councillor Moran. Councillor Sims, please.
Just ask a question and then make some comments. Could I ask administration procedurally, what would be the process if we were to reopen the Flinders Franklin path? Would that be an easy thing to do in terms of kicking this along?
Through the chair, I might defer that question to Rudy. We have asked for that advice, and Rudy's probably best placed to answer it.
Through the presiding member, a specific rescission motion would be the cleanest in that it would make absolutely clear what council wants. However, if the decision were to be so obvious that out of that decision it is implied that the earlier decision is rescinded, then you don't need a specific rescission motion, but it is the most clear option to do. So for example, if you were to say for council to investigate constructing a bikeway in a particular street, that would obviously rescind the earlier decision, but it would be more clear to say that in those words and then provide an alternative option in the same motion.
Thank you. So the preliminary work on Flinders Franklin has been done. So if a rescission motion was passed, we could then progress that. That's correct, isn't it?
Through the chair, we would just need to refresh that work. In fairness, that work was undertaken some years ago, so we would need to just refresh that work.
Sure. Look, in terms of feedback, I read through the report. I noticed the loss of car parking, which has been reported in the media. I know some elected members have concerns about the loss of 400 car spaces. I would make the point, though, this is in Weymouth, Piri, I would make the point, though, that is less than 1% of the number of car parks we have in the city of Adelaide. We don't have a car parking shortage. In fact, we have more car parks than any other capital city in the country. We at best have an 80% occupancy rate of those car parks. And what was really interesting too, from my perspective, is we have even more car parks than the city of Sydney. So we have a significant number of car parks in our city. My personal view is I think we could afford to lose some car parks so that we can accommodate this cycling infrastructure. So if it was the will of council, I would be supportive of Weymouth Pirie because I want to see this work being done. However, I get the sense that support for that option is evaporating. It is correct what Councillor Martin has said in that there was consensus previously for Flinders Franklin, then there was a push to reopen and look at this option. I'd like to see us, if this is not a live option, to go back to Flinders Franklin and start to advance that. What is not an option for me is looking at some sort of third pathway and kicking this down the can for another 12 months. I'm really anxious about the fact that we have a time frame approaching, and if we don't spend this money, we're going to be wasting millions of dollars that could be available to us to upgrade cycling infrastructure in our city. I think that would be hugely embarrassing for our council. I think it would undermine confidence in the council. Irrespective of the debate about cycling infrastructure, I just wonder what sort of message we would send if the state government gives us millions of dollars to build a project and we don't complete it within the time frame because we can't settle on a plan amongst ourselves. I think that would be deeply embarrassing for us and undermine our capacity to get support for other important infrastructure projects in the city in the future. So I'd urge elected members to get behind an option. If it is not the Weymouth Pirie, then it has to be Flinders Franklin. Let's get behind that and let's make this happen as a priority. Otherwise, we're going to completely miss the boat. And I think that would be deeply embarrassing for our city. In terms of the benefits of cycling infrastructure, I think they're self-evident, but our country has literally been on fire over summer this year. We're in the middle of a climate emergency. We've got a plan to reduce our carbon emissions in the CBD. We're never going to be able to do that if we don't roll out cycling infrastructure and make some serious inroads in terms of encouraging cycling in the city. So, you know, I urge members to stop the analysis paralysis, stop the backpedaling, stop sending this off for further investigation. Let's agree on a plan and make it happen.
Councillor Martin.
Yeah, thank you. A question, and I can speak twice, can't I? And that is in the previous item.
You can speak as many times as you want, Councillor.
Chair, can I ask why then it is necessary to stop someone speaking at 3 minutes but allow them to speak again?
Because those are the rules.
Okay, well, we need to change
those.
Making
it up as you go along.
Could I ask the administration, if Pirie Weymouth is abandoned as the selected route for the east-west bikeway and some other third option, and just to be crazy, let me suggest Wakefield Road is used, how long would there be a delay, or how long would the delay be in order to complete the necessary work to present a report to council to endorse?
Through the chair, so if we were to provide a report to council with a decision from this workshop, that would go into, help me, we would probably report in April. We have missed the deadlines for March. And then presumably there would be a decision out of that. We would then have to go back and do some work to understand whichever corridor is selected. Depending on which corridor is selected will determine the extent of work that we would have to do. If it's a corridor we have never looked at, then we would have to start more or less from scratch. That does take some time. Without trying to preempt an answer of what that time could be. It could be 6 to 10 months.
And therefore, given that this particular proposal has taken 11 months to come back, 11 months would be not out of the question.
Through the chair, depending on which corridor was nominated, would determine what the answer is to that question.
And another question, if another option were chosen and the matter was delayed until 2021, is it likely that the state government would seek to retrieve the money which it had given for the construction of the east-west bikeway to the council?
Through the chair, we've been advised by Dipti that the funds that Dipti has allocated for bikeways spending in the city through the deed needs to be expended by the 30th of June 2021. We have not sought to understand whether there might be any potential to have that extended.
So therefore, am I understanding it correctly that unless the bikeway is completed, as far as we know, by June 2021, the money will be withdrawn?
Through the chair, at this stage, and without having further analysed or questioned or sought feedback from Dipti, yes, that's the answer.
And therefore, in those circumstances, there would be no east-west bikeway unless council funded it separately.
Through the chair, council has allocated its half of the $5.5 million worth of funding. We would be able to deliver something within that, within those funds. It may not necessarily be a separated bikeway, which is what the funding deed calls for.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Councillor Knoll.
I think you've just sort of got to the answer, because I was just interested, because I look at the various options you may have, but if the deed requires us to have a separate bikeway, I look at this, there's quite a few options where you would not necessarily need to do that. Is there an option to be able to say, okay, here is an acceptable method of which we can accommodate vehicles and bikes? Because it means, particularly period, that's my thought process in the original the reason why I supported it was that the traffic is slow anyway, and it would be a lot safer place too for the bikes and vehicles to share. So is this something that can be entertained as a solution, given that, you know, if the work is done, it says, oh, that this is potentially a way to get around the issue and still deliver something that's safe and practical?
Through the chair, putting the funding deed to one side, it is council's prerogative to decide what method of infrastructure they wish to install. If council's view is that a not fully separated bikeway is what they wish to pursue, then we would pursue that and understand what might be possible.
Does that answer your question? Yes, members. Councillor Donald.
Thank you. Why would we choose to install a separated bikeway rather than a painted line on the ground?
It's been shown in studies and in other cities that separated bikeways are much more likely to get those people at the moment that don't ride but would quite like to ride onto their bikes and riding into cities. They are much safer than painted lines on the road, and they're much more likely to increase the number of people riding into the city.
Okay, so we'd be more likely to convert people who are currently choosing to drive to people who would choose to cycle, and therefore reducing congestion by putting more than just a painted line on the ground.
Correct.
Yes. Right. And what were the three routes that were initially considered for the east-west?
The three initial routes that were considered were the Piri-Weymouth Corridor, the Flinders-Franklin Corridor, and the Grote-Wakefield.
And why was the Grote-Wakefield option discounted?
In our original analysis, we discounted the Piri-Weymouth Corridor because we deemed it too narrow at that stage. We then did an analysis between Flinders-Franklin and Grote-Wakefield. The analysis at the time showed that the Grote-Wakefield corridor was further away from where people actually wanted to be. People generally want to be in the CBD, where most of the offices are and the shopping areas are. And that also, from a bike riding point of view, it would be a slower journey on a bike along Grote-Wakefield, because he would have to stop and give way to passengers getting on and off buses at the 20 or so bus stops that are on that corridor. So it would be a lower level of service for bike riders than a bikeway on the Flinders Franklin corridor. That was the main reason, along with things like Victoria Square that gets closed during events, which would obviously disrupt the bikeway. They were the key reasons.
And when you speak to that lower level of service and the decreased speed, how is it perceived, that conflict with people getting off a bus? I'm just trying to visualise it, thinking about, for example, the spots along Frome where there are cars that pull in and they're coming off out of their cars or out of their buses, and then they're going across the separated bikeway. How are those conflict points perceived from a transport planners' perspective in terms of safety?
We would see it adding more conflicts onto the bikeway, so it would be a risk for the pedestrians, the people getting onto and off the buses, as well as to the bike riders. Just so you can visualise it more, that the bus stops would be designed similar to the front of the Majestic Hotel and the Mantra Hotel on the existing Frome bikeway. So we would expect to have a little zebra crossing, so that people getting on and off the buses would have priority and the bike riders would need to slow down. But there's always that risk of conflicts when you've got people interacting in a city like that.
And based on the information from when you previously looked at those points, it looks as though there's about 20 of those points across the street were it to be on.
That's correct.
So 20 conflict points.
Yeah, there were around 20 bus stops on that corridor when we did that analysis. I'm not quite sure how many it would be today, but it would be similar.
Similar, okay. And then looking at Flinders Franklin, we've got this presentation which looks at 336 car parks. When you compare to Flinders Franklin and the work that you've done on Flinders Franklin, what was the car park impact there?
I couldn't tell you off the top of my head, I'm afraid. It was less than 400, and we could certainly fit parking in there as well as a bike lane.
Mm-hmm. And was that, from my memory of it, it was more like the Frome where there was only the highest level of car park loss occurred during peak times, but during off-peak times, it was actually a relatively small car park.
Correct.
Reduction.
So it's a wider street corridor, so there are a number of ways you could lay the street out. Our recommendation at the time was to lay it out like we've laid the Frome street corridor out, so we would have two lanes of traffic in each direction during peak times, and then parking in off-peak times.
Okay. And so when we look at the three options, as you've spoke to, the Great Wakefield, the primary challenges there are all those conflict points and the fact that it's a lower service to the cyclists.
Yep.
The Piri Weymouth, there's the issues, the technical challenges of going through the squares. There's the need for a pedestrian crossing at West Terrace, and then the much higher loss of car parking. And with Flinders, it's a wider street. It's a much lower number of car parks. Are there any of those technical challenges that arise with the Flinders Franklin?
There are some technical challenges, particularly on the outer edges of the city. So the eastern and western ends, where the street is laid out currently slightly differently. We've got angle parking and various other infrastructure such as electricity poles, etc. in that area. So there will be some technical challenges, but in our opinion, they won't be difficult to overcome.
Okay. So as our marvellous transport planners, and having looked now at those three options, what would be your recommendation as to which would be the best option for us to put the east-west?
We would stand by our original analysis and the original recommendation that we made, that Flinders Franklin would be our preferred corridor.
Anyone think you're a lawyer with that cross-examination? Councillor Munn.
But just a quick question in relation to that third route, Great Wakefield. How did the administration envisage that the challenge of Tasting Australia, Tour Down Under, Thinker in Residence and other programs, which closes Victoria Square for long periods, would be overcome?
Through the chair, Anna did mention that is a challenge, and so we would need to work out a solution for that particular challenge, which we haven't.
Ah, I see. There is no solution in the past.
not one that we have necessarily sorted out.
Alan?
Thank you, Chair. Just a quick question in relation to the government, state government funding. Now, this June 2021 deadline, is that deadline for spending the money or is that for committing it? So do we need to be at contract execution or do we need to be at practical completion?
Good question. My understanding is that we would have had to have expended the money.
Oh, so not necessarily committed, but it has to be spent.
Yes, that's my understanding, but that's something we could clarify.
Yeah, through the chair, with regard to finance, a bit of interest in the funding deed and the commitments we have. Certainly, there is nothing to prevent us approaching the minister for a further extension. That has occurred in the past, and that has been provided to us in good faith. I believe, though, we would need to go back this time if we were to seek an extension with absolute clarity and a clear path of milestones to enable delivery to occur for any further extension to happen. If that is able to be made, I believe that there will be a reasonable response. I'm going to be able to construct without needing to rush the construction work, which no one would want to see. So I believe common sense would prevail.
Just to follow up, just to refresh my memory, what was the state government contribution here?
Through the chair, the funding deed was for $12 million for the North, South and the East West Parkway, $6 million from council and $6 million from the state government.
Thank you. Members, further questions? Members? All right, I just have a couple of questions. Thank you for the presentation. Very interesting, and I know it's been a long road to get to this point. The funding deed, so that was that extended just once or twice?
Remember, it's been extended twice.
But once in this council term. I remember we did it once, I don't think we did it twice.
Yeah.
Okay. When we're talking about, so we've got 5.5 to spend, half of which is ours, half of which isn't. When we're talking about the cost of a separated bikeway, how much, can you just remind me, how much did Frome cost, the Frome Street bikeway?
Through the chair, I haven't got that detail here tonight. I'm happy to provide a breakdown of the different costs of the different segments of the bikeway completed today.
Okay, because I understood it to be around 18 million, but I didn't want to throw that out there. Without 18, was it not 18? Or
no.
14? There's no, it's definitely in the table.
That wouldn't be right.
Well, I think that really needs to be provided to us beforehand. Now, as well with that corridor, that's not all complete yet, is it? The north-south.
Through the chair, the north-south corridor is indeed incomplete. There are some impediments in the way at the moment, literally. So the Adelaidean development and the adjoining student accommodation tower takes up a significant portion of Frome Street. So we're awaiting some clearances around when that's likely to occur. We are aware that the old budget motor site, which is a tiny site on the, yeah, it's right, the north, the southeast corner of Frome Street, has DA approved over it, and so we're unclear as to when that is likely to take place. So we are trying to understand what that might mean, and of course what happens with Lot 14 in terms of opportunities to extend the bikeway either through Lot 14 or in Frome Road needs to be resolved as well.
So we're waiting for the Adelaidean to be finished and we might have to wait for that building to go up on that other site. We just don't know, is that?
That is potentially the case, yes.
What's the time till the Adelaidean is expected to, if not have finished, at least vacated the space that we wish to have?
Through the chair, the Adelaidean, we understand, is due for completion sometime this year. Can't tell you what month that is, but we have been assured that it will be sometime this year. However, the site on the corner of North Terrace and Throne Road, right adjoining the Adelaidean, has only just commenced construction. We understand that site will be occupied for construction with hoarding within the perimeter of Frome Street for some time into the future.
What's some time? I'm trying to get an idea of how long it's going to take to finish this first corridor.
Probably 18 months.
18 months. So effectively it'll be at least 18 months before we can finish the north-south.
At least on one site.
Yes. Yeah. But potentially if that other site on the corner, if they actually decide to build, then we'd wait for that as well.
Yes, that's correct.
Understood. And I suppose that brings me to Prue Weymouth again. There's a lot of construction that's pegged to happen along this corridor, the one that's in question. Would that similarly delay the delivery of, if we did hypothetically go with the Prue Weymouth Street corridor, would that delay that rollout again?
Through the chair, whichever corridor was selected, we would need to understand what's forecast in terms of potential impacts on the street, and then we would work around those impediments, whatever they might be.
The first one that springs to mind is the Hyatt. That's quite a big building. Do you know how long that's going to be under construction for?
Through the chair, my understanding is that project has got some delays in it, so we don't even know when the construction is likely to commence.
But something like that will take a couple of years.
When they commence construction, generally as a rule of thumb, we work off 18 months to 2 years, yes.
Yep. Okay, understood. I guess that just, for me, I'll just give a really quick comment. That for me highlights some of the issues going into this. The fact that $5.5 million isn't going to pay for what the full cost of delivering in East-West. Now, notwithstanding that we don't necessarily need to have the Taj Mahal option that the previous council decided for Frome Street, noting that they were actually cleaning up a mess that was left to them by the council before that, so you can see how long this saga has been dragging out. I would say I am concerned about the overall cost in the long term, but if we manage to get the corridor right, I would be happy for us to invest over and above, and potentially might even be happy for another Taj Mahal option, given it's actually very well received by the community and they say the outcome is good, notwithstanding the enormous amount of pain, angst, reputational damage to the city it caused to get us there. And I think that's actually caused by how it was handled in the first place. There was a lot of community opposition when it just popped up out of nowhere as a decision of the then CEO. So
that's actually not true.
Okay. I take that. Apologies.
I was
still in high school at the time. Let's.
You should have been watching council meetings.
Great entertainment.
Should have been getting an education.
So the problems here are, to my mind, Perry Weymouth, you're going to lose too much parking. You're going to lose way too much parking, and you're going to lose the revenue associated with that parking. You're going to be stopping businesses from having their customers access them easily. You're going to be stopping businesses and other tenants, offices, service providers, and that sort of thing, from being able to receive parcels, shipments, and all sorts of other things that all these loading zones are used for. We know that Prue Weymouth, and we walk down it most days when we come into Town Hall, is a street that is whereas a corridor that's often very close to capacity, what we would consider ideal capacity, or around 80%. And so I think, for me personally, that rules this option out categorically and entirely. I don't think it's a good place to put a bikeway because of the issues, because of the space required and how we would displace and essentially alienate our ratepayers and our businesses and their tenants from those people that wish to access their buildings. So if we want to think about access, we're really, really inhibiting access. Noting as well that between large parts of Perry and Weymouth, there aren't actually a lot of parking. particularly around here at Town Hall as well. Now, further down there's a car park, we own a couple. Further up there is a car park, but there isn't much in between that, and so I struggle to think about how people will get in and out of the street easily. I've been very clear that in looking at the three options, and I did look at the three options after this came up again, my preference is for a Grove Wakefield option to be pursued. And I think in doing that, you can actually answer, or at least there can be some groundwork done to determine whether or not there can be any benefit extracted out of that. And the way that I came to that sort of conclusion was looking at the corridor, looking at the previous report that was provided, it's almost exactly the same number of cyclists that go down Perry and Weymouth that go down Grove and Wakefield. There's only a marginal increase with the Perry and Weymouth corridor. And I think that's key. Acknowledging that we do have the issues with the buses along the corridor, that is one of the widest, if not the widest, road corridors in the city of Adelaide. And so I think we should be able to find a solution that accommodates cars, angle parking, buses, and bikes along that track. For us to stand up and decide that we're a city where we can only have a tram corridor, or can only have a bus corridor, or can only have a bicycle way, or can only have cars on a particular section of road, cars and parking, I think is a bit of a cop-out. I think we should be able to do better than that, especially when we've got the space. We can't possibly have a city where you dedicate one corridor to one mode of transport. It just doesn't work. And I think looking at the city access strategy, it was all about integration. Time is up, thank you, Councillor. It was all about integration. So those are my thoughts. Similarly, thinking about the almost $30 million we're about to invest in the Central Market Arcade redevelopment, delivering people to that investment, to that precinct, I think would be a key outcome. Those are my thoughts. I'm happy to take further feedback offline from councillors on that. Being the last speaker, quickly, Councillor Martin.
How come you're the last speaker?
That's what the chair does. He sums up last, and I waited a good 10 seconds before I decided to speak, but you may speak again.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Look, I just wanted to give some feedback in respect of the option that is being put forward. It seems to me, my personal view, that we are putting forward just exactly the same tactic that Hassan did. Let's go down another pathway that will delay it even further. And I can't help but speculate that the intention of Team Adelaide is to delay the installation of a bikeway running east-west in the city of Adelaide for so long that the government, out of frustration, will simply withdraw the funds. That is the plan. It worked once. It looks like it's going to have another run.
Sorry, Councillor, can you clarify how it worked once?
I'm saying to you that the selection of an option to be investigated, which had been previously ruled out, has delayed any progress on an east-west bikeway for almost a year. The selection of yet another option that has been previously ruled out will simply delay this process for almost another year. And the likely outcome is that the government will withdraw the funding. The government will decide that we are such a bunch of ditherers that it wants its money back. That is substantial reputational damage, and it would be on your head. Oh, I don't mean you personally, I mean Team Adelaide, sorry.
Councillor Moran.
As a party to the discussions at the last council, which chair you weren't, it was clear that the Perry Street was put there to obfuscate the, it's clear to anybody, unless you make a one-way street or no-car street, it's totally inappropriate for bikes. Flinders Franklin was the street that you've heard tonight, the administration prefer. It was stopped entirely by the uproar from the businesses on that street. I met with them myself, with Alexantic, and we were sympathetic to their plight. And also, we wanted to wait till we'd done the argument at the time was to wait till we'd actually done Prime Road in a proper way, because at the time we started this, we had the clunky old one, and nobody liked it. The last thing they wanted was something like that, so we wanted to have the good prototype. If you go to Wakefield Grove, you'll have the same traders, the same businesses doing exactly the same thing and pressuring the business vote, business candidates, and the people to get their votes from there. So it'll be exactly the same, and the result will be exactly the same. You'll be influenced, and I wasn't completely unable to be influenced on it myself. But there is no advantage in just choosing another street. You'll have the same problems. If this council really wants to have a dedicated east-west bike lane, it has to bite the bullet, withstand the anger of the traders and businesses, and you've got the market there, and lose some car parks. Well, you haven't been here very long, Fran. I can assure you, every single business and
councillors, direct your remarks through the chair.
We'll be there. Well, could you ask him not to interrupt when I'm talking?
Councillor, you addressed him first. I'm asking you to address your remarks through the chair.
I said they've got the market there. France, last time I checked, was not...
We're not going to get into a tit-for-tat, Councillor.
Well, I certainly win that on internet, but nevertheless. You will face the same problems in Wakefield Grove that you faced in Flinders Franklin, and you'd have a less good street. If you're going to be brave and have an east-west, I know as sure as I sit here that we will not get one more inch of dedicated bike lanes while this faction rules. Even though Sandy must be for it, I think you will break away from her and vote against it, and I can hear it already now. So I'm not going to stick my neck out, but if the best solution was Flinders and Franklin, you'd be told that. Same problems will happen with the other street. Peary Street was never going to fly. We all knew that. It was a delaying tactic. So, you know, be sensible. It's going to be hard to get one in. The businesses hate it. The emergency vehicles hate it. The businesses should like it, as Helen said, because in the fullness of time, it actually helps. But they 100% don't feel like that. And that is why, unfortunately, the team will vote politically. I'll vote for it. And I know others will, but I could say, I would bet you $1 million on that.
Thank you, Councillor. Thank you for your presentation, Shanti. Now, members, we're moving on to workshop 4.3. The 2020-2021 business plan and budget. Thank you, Tracy and Alex, and I believe the CEO is going to pipe us in for this one.
Thanks, Chair.
Can we please have some silence?
So the purpose of this session, which is a really important one, is to consider our response to the principles and considerations of the 2020-2021 business plan and budget. So it's an important session tonight, and the business plan and budget is really integral to ensuring our financial sustainability of our services and our capacity to maintain our assets, which is something you should be fully aware of. Following feedback from last year and also the internal audit that was undertaken, the information tonight is being presented differently to you. I'm interested in your feedback on that as well. Tonight we really do seek your engagement and as we develop the budget with you. So Tracy and Alex are going to lead us through. So thanks, Tracy.
And conscious of time, if you can.
Speak fast.
Keep it to the close. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. So as Mark has stated, the purpose of this workshop is to consider the key principles and considerations for the 2021 business plan and budget. The initial feedback we receive this evening will set the parameters for the consideration of the draft budget, which we'll present on the 24th of March, and further consideration and balancing of the draft budget and long-term financial plan in April, prior to going to consultation in May. The principles we discuss tonight will be central to ensuring the financial sustainability of council services and its capacity to maintain the city's assets. Key issues under consideration include being financially responsible and sustainable, delivering services efficiently and effectively, creating the capacity to fund the current and emerging priorities and projects, maintaining and enhancing infrastructure, repayment of borrowings, and ensuring council is in a strong financial position will enable us to mitigate council's key financial risks, including our capacity to respond to emerging priorities and our capacity to repay borrowings. So this slide is around our principles. So in preparation for considering the 2021 budget, there are some key principles that should be central to our thinking. Firstly, operating surpluses should be achieved to ensure financial sustainability.
Is this how we're going to do it now? Just read PowerPoint presentations, presuming that we haven't read it. No disrespect, but we really ruled that out last term because it's boring, and we had presumably read it.
Councillor, I'll take that as a comment. Tracy is giving us the most crucial information.
Have an influence, but having stuff we've read out to you again is unbelievably mind-numbing.
Thank you, Councillor. Tracy, can you keep it to the explanation of the slides as opposed to the slides itself?
So it will only achieve long-term financial sustainability if our operational income you receive fully funds our operational services and our investment infrastructure, parklands, property and plant and equipment. Noting the current long-term financial plan is forecasting deficits, but we want to bring these back to surpluses. As we'll discuss further in the presentation, we are heavily reliant on income from rates and parking. So this is a concern to have a majority of income concentrated in two areas. We're also relying on new developments bringing growth increases to our rate revenue. So this really leads to the questions around whether elected members are open to considering new avenues of revenue. We need to ensure our longer term financial sustainability. Our rates must align to our service levels and our core infrastructure required to keep the city functioning. Our fees and charges need to cover the cost of providing the services, including principles on the value of public space. As outlined in the December workshop, we have simplified the budget categories, grants and sponsorship and ongoing services, including the free City Connector bus, will now be treated as pilot operations. We'll provide more details in the March workshop. As emergent priorities arise throughout the year, we need to identify what services or activities we will stop or reduce to accommodate new priorities rather than additional pressures on successive budgets. The core infrastructure program should be focused on evidence-based assessments for conditions and risks, with renewals prioritised ahead of enhancements. We will need a strategy to reduce debt. We need to formulate this as part of the budget process and incorporate into the long-term financial plan. I would like to make a correction to what is shown on the slide around borrowings. It's a pretty rigid statement that we put up there. So this should say future borrowings should be prioritised towards income generating opportunities. And as you'll see, the statement around strategic property review, as we are doing the Central Mark Arcade, we need to make sure we're guiding our future investment is focused on income generating assets. And we'd also like to recognise where the state government has ceased funding something, that we need to recognise whether it's a responsibility that we have and whether we want to clearly understand whether it's our responsibility to still provide that service as well. So from the principles that we've shown, we are really looking for your feedback on whether you consider any principle is more important than another one, or whether you have a differing view on what we've discussed. This will help shape our budget going forward. So do you have any comments or questions on these principles before Alex moves forward with the rest of the presentation?
Councillor Sims and Councillor Mark.
Thank you. Just to clarify, what's meant when you talk about shifting accounting for business as usual projects as part of operations? You referenced the community bus. What do you mean by that in practical terms?
You may remember our last budget process last year. We had around $20 million worth of projects, but some of them are really considered business as usual projects. So we have funding for Christmas in the city and things that will happen every year anyway. So rather than have them separated as a project on their own, we've now included them as business as usual operations.
Does that mean then that theoretically it could be changed without a decision of council if it's part of the general operations budget?
No, that's not true. And we'll actually make sure we still have clarity around where they sit and we still have oversight of those projects.
Right. Okay. Look, that sounds like a good outcome.
Councillor Martin.
Yes. In relation to the principal fees and charges based on user pay principles, would appear to put in doubt such things as the decision of council to waive the cost of outdoor dining fees. Is that correct?
Sorry, no, that's not the intent where there's been decisions of council. We are not looking to change those decisions, but where possible, we would seek to make sure, and when it's not also ruled by legislation, where possible, we should be charging what is costing us for the services.
So fees and charges is based on user principles, except where council decides otherwise. I'm not being cheeky, but basically that's what I mean. Okay. I do not agree with new priorities be funded through the redirection of existing budgets, given that there are, as is noted here, quarterly revised forecasts, at which time funds are redirected, often to the bottom line, carried forward, or in some cases diverted to other projects. It's my view that council should make those decisions about whether new priorities are funded through revised forecasts. That should be an option. And the other thing is that the debt redemption plan is a priority. Yes, I agree with that, but I do think it's open to council to decide whether and how much debt is repaid, and whether that is a priority in any given year over a particular project, which may have a priority.
Through the chair, that is correct. The budgeting process is the council's decision as to what it would look like. I guess we're trying to have some overarching principles. So where we've talked about new priorities being funded through the redirection of budget, it is to avoid, I guess, a lot of requests going up where the response is it will be part of the next year or part of the next budget process, but there's not actually a overarching consideration of how we would fund that or what we're going to stop to fund that or what that looks like, so as to have a more considered approach that there isn't a never-ending bucket of money and how it would be redistributed that and spent, which of course is through council decisions anyway.
Thank you.
Councillor Donovan.
Thank you. Those principles all look very rational. One thing with the strategic property review, I just want us to be careful in how we define performing and non-performing assets, and looking at it beyond financial or economic performance, keeping in mind that we have some social and affordable housing within our strategic property portfolio, and to ensure that within that, whilst it's not council's role to provide social housing, we do have some, so we wouldn't want to look at a net loss over time because we're divesting of those assets. So just making sure that we're considering performance in other ways other than just financial outcomes.
Well, through the chair, I think that's well understood, and hopefully we can get even better outcomes in some of those spaces from divestment into further investment. So I think we're trying to demonstrate that at the moment on a couple of projects, particularly with affordable housing, but I take the point around social housing as well.
Members, any more further feedback on these principles?
On the principles.
On the principles. No? Okay, just quickly. Operating surplus should be funded.
Late to the party. Just in terms of borrowing should only be utilised for income generating opportunities. I think we would prioritise it for income opportunities, but it might not be the only thing. I think if we use that as the rule, then that doesn't allow us to borrow if there's something, an opportunity or something that we actually want to deliver, particularly in terms of the community area. And the redirection of existing budgets, I think they come in each time anyway. Additional funding, it depends whether our forecast then is going to increase or not. So if it's contained within budget, then I think that's one conversation. If it's outside of budget, then that's another. So happy to look at that as that comes in.
Thank you. Members, Councillor Kerr.
Yeah, I'll just really briefly, I think it's paramount that we stress efficiency and efficiency gains right now. We are absolutely in a recession. If we weren't in a recession before, if we were in a recession before, the circumstances of late last year have well and truly put us between the virus and the bushfires. Things are not looking rosy. Their businesses are absolutely on a knife edge. But it's, you know, It's never too soon to reiterate the need for efficiency. I do believe there is a virtuous circle. If you get the cost base down, you get capital inflows into the city, you expand your rate base. And I think that's something we've just got to keep paramount. I don't actually think rates are inherently a problem in terms, I think there's something democratically kind of sound about rates being the main basis, because constituents then see clearly what their expenditure is on local government as opposed to shifting completely to income generating. That is not to say we shouldn't try to reduce rates. I think that's not mutually exclusive, but we've got to be realistic about the options that we do have to reduce to generate income from other spaces. If we encourage capital inflows, if we encourage vehicle inflows, if we proceed now, borrowing costs are low. We shouldn't be afraid of borrowing when borrowing costs are low if we have a sound business case for what we borrow for. But if we proceed effectively with things like parking parking point schemes that encourage people to come and shop and redeem their parking costs, if we can get that sort of thing up and running effectively like other cities do, we can see an uplift in some of those parking income streams, I think. But we
Thank you, Jesse. Members, further feedback? No, just quickly, I'll reiterate Councillor Kira's points. Just say there is definitely, I think, an appetite amongst members to invest in revenue generating streams, and considering debt is cheap, then we can entertain that as an option if the costs stack up. I don't think we should limit ourselves or what we think we can achieve as far as revenue streams go, just with the prudential borrowing limit. I would just say, given I'm talking to the finance department, just touching on Councillor Donovan's point, I think the role of the finance department is to make a financial judgment on something, whether it's performing or non-performing. It's then the role of us to then decide whether or not we think it's performing a social value or not, and whether or not we think that outweighs the risk there. So I don't by any means think, I wouldn't expect our finance department to make that judgment call. In fact, I think it needs to be made by us. So I make that point. The other thing I would say, would you just be able to explain new priorities funded through the redirection of existing budgets? Because Councillor Martin touched on that. Could you just elaborate on that a little bit?
If we, for example, go back through this previous financial year where we have some motions on notice that include a budgeted or a non-budgeted amount of a financial impact for a decision that's been made or suggested, a lot of the time the reference to the cost is referred to be funded through a quarterly financial adjustment or to be considered in a future budget, which is what we do. However, there isn't a pot of money we put aside for things like that. So it means that we either increase our borrowings, have to stop doing something, or redirect some of the funding. So if we've made savings within a quarterly adjustment, we can redirect some of those priorities. But if we haven't, we have to consider how would we actually fund those.
Well, I think that makes a lot of sense. I think that's the basis upon which people are operating on. If something is carried forward, then we think it's carried forward. And if something's a Q1 saving, then it's a Q1 saving. If in an accounting sense, you've got a pool over here and a pot over here, and you're not able to go between the two, then I think that's silly to limit yourselves in that sense. I would just say as well, on a principle matter, when we come to user pay systems, they're generally thought of as more equitable. However, I'm thinking of there's an ideological argument there, but I'm thinking of the current state of play, and when I'm looking at rates reflect the cost of delivering services and core assets, I mean, if you look at that in a user pays context, whose rates reflect what services they're getting. I think it's very interesting if you open that can of worms. I would be interested to see it. And I think it actually leads us down the path which I would like to see us go down, which is reducing the rate in the dollar, reducing council rates. That's ultimately where we should be going. We should be a lean, mean, efficient government. Don't take the mean literally, Councillor Simpson.
Sounds like what you're saying is pretty mean.
But we should be, well, what I do think is mean, I think it's mean for us to be charging people rates when they see zero services from us. And I'm thinking about waste, I'm thinking about us not collecting the bins of apartment buildings or businesses, not offering businesses green waste. I think that's an inequitable outcome. I think they're paying for a service and they're not getting anything from it.
Absolutely.
So I'm very happy for those things to be considered in a budget. But ultimately, we should be funding as much as we can the delivery of our services through revenue gained through a service, through some sort of good or service delivered to the public. I think that's what happens with some of our commercial assets, and that bolsters our budget considerably. We should be looking to offset rates wherever we can through those revenue streams. I think that's the way we should be operating, and if ever we can, we should be delivering a reduced rate in the dollar.
Sorry, through the chair, before Alex continues with the presentation, I just want to make a clarifying point. Our rates are considered like a tax, so they're not a user-specific, user pays for the rates. That comment is around our fees and charges.
No, I get that, but we're the cost of delivering services, but the cost of delivering services to who? That was a question. If you think about that, from different perspectives, you'll get different answers. That's why I just say be wary about opening that can of worms.
Through the chair, so the next slide talks to our annual funding requirement, which in other words is our funding surplus or deficit. And this is generated by the income we make through rates and parking and other things, which I'll go through in a minute, and is used to fund our operations, our projects, and our infrastructure. Now, as you'll see in the long-term financial plan, based on what was presented at QF2, we have got a deficit for the next 4 years. Now, that is predominantly due to two things. One is the activities around property investments and also carry forwards. If we look at 2021, we've got a forecast deficit of approximately $7 million. That is 4.6 of that relates to carry forwards, and about 2.8 of that relates to decline in income because of the wind down of the central market arcade. 21-22 and 22-23, the deficits are predominantly due to the investment in the central market arcade. If you take care of both the carry forwards and the investments, we will be effectively in a break-even position in those next 3 years. An operating surplus is obviously important as well, but it provides the capacity for us to fund our priorities, including the delivery of services, infrastructure, strategic plan, and also we can only repay borrowings if we do have an operating surplus or we do choose to divest of assets. In terms of the next steps in relation to this, we've obviously had a discussion around the principle of funding services. And then in March, we will bring forward an end-to-end view of the budget. We will present operations and do that with a view by service category. We'll present projects, and as Tracy has already mentioned, we will clearly delineate between what has been moved into operations, provide details of that, and we'll also provide the infrastructure program. Moving to the next slide, this is a summary breakdown of our income. Now, the important thing to understand here is that we've reflected the graph to be the income from rates and then the net income we receive from parking, which includes the income from the U-Parks. Effectively, beyond that, the other businesses don't contribute profit as such, or surplus, and equally there are some other activities including the subsidiaries, which obviously we have income go in and then expenditure go out. So what we're trying to do here is just get a very clear view of what funding, the net funding that's coming in to fund our operational services that we provide. So 67% is rates, approximately 20% is parking, there's on-street parking, off-street parking, and income from expiations. And then beyond that, you've got property, and then there's about $11 million, which is a combination of some minor grants and sponsorships, also grants and subsidies we receive, and also money from fees and charges. So the important thing we need to consider here is obviously our forecast growth and rates. I'll get to that in more detail in a moment. The role of on-street and off-street parking, and Ian, you might want to make a comment on that in a moment. Other opportunities including that we have new revenue streams. We have mentioned previously that we may be opportunities to leverage our infrastructure and also consider third-party advertising. And then leveraging our strategic property review potentially for new income operating income opportunities there as well. So it's just important to really understand the dependency on both the rates and the park. Ian, did you want to add anything?
No, just through the chair. So we're doing a piece of work around on an off-street car parking. So really smart guy, Sean Cools and our UPAP team and some people in Vanessa's team. Just getting that relationship between an off-street car parking work better. They don't talk to each other as from the consumer's perspective. We don't have things like dynamic pricing where we might want to change real-time pricing in new parks, for example, so the consumers would know that there is capacity and be able to guarantee themselves a car park. So some investment in systems that allow us to utilise the assets better in the new park system and how off-street and on-street talk to itself. So there's a piece of dedicated work going on about that at the moment.
Is the floor open now? Thank you, Alex. Excellent. Councillor Smith.
Thank you. Look, just some general feedback on the principles that you've spoken to. I guess when we talk about the desirability of a surplus, I mean, I agree that is desirable, but I guess for me the question becomes at what cost? I wouldn't want us to be focusing on having a surplus if that meant that we were cutting services, or if it meant that we're having to cut staff or not do the kind of things that we think are valuable, then I think that wouldn't be a worthwhile objective. So for me, a surplus is, you know, something you have when you've met all of your expenses. It's not something we aim to achieve and then make cuts to try and get there. We've seen what happens with that in other levels of government, and I don't think the outcomes are positive. In terms of user pays philosophy, I think, you know, it makes sense in terms of fees and charges. I don't think it makes sense in terms of access to community services. I'd hate for us to go down that path. You know, you don't want to be charging people to use the public library and things like that. We're a level of government, we provide a public service, and that means those things have got to be accessible to everybody, and we shouldn't be charging to use them. So I don't want us to go down that path. In terms of issues around car parking revenue, I know that other cities around the world have started looking at raising car parking fees at different periods as a way of trying to encourage other transport options. And you know, I think that's something we could really look at within our city and look at what is best practice overseas in terms of speaking to the presentation we had earlier about what we can do to encourage other transport options, incentivize more sustainable transport options or car sharing and so on. A really good way to do that is by looking at the price point. So that's something I'd like us to look at. A few people have spoken to the issue of rates. I mean, everybody knows my view on rates. I'm sort of in the camp of saying that we should entertain increasing rates, recognising, of course, that there are exemptions to that on the basis of financial disadvantage and so on. And I'd like to see, you know, those exemptions beefed up and more support provided to people who are experiencing financial hardship, whether they be residents or businesses, with then us bringing in revenue through other means. So, you know, I would like us to be a bit more open to that discussion. What I would hate is for us to find ourselves in a situation where we're starting to make cuts to services or not able to do things that we'd like to do because we don't have the revenue coming in. I assume we're going to talk a bit more about the rates issue, so I'll perhaps ask a few questions of the CEO around that when we get to it.
Thank you. Members, Councillor.
Just briefly.
Councillor.
I just want to clarify the reference to the annual funding graph, which you observed was negatively affected until 23-24 because of Central Market Arcade redevelopment doesn't reflect that cost will be a negative cost until 2040. That's correct, isn't it?
That's not correct.
There's no positive income to 2039?
No, that's not correct, but I'll take that on notice to provide the accurate information to you.
Thank you. I note also under next steps, the presentation of the draft budget in March means that on page 19, where the workshops are set up, we'll actually contribute our thoughts to that once it's been presented. So we'll get the cake and then we'll be able to put the ingredients in or adjust the ingredients. Is that the intention?
We'll talk to that in a moment.
Okay, that's fine. And just one other matter in relation to considerations, leveraging the property portfolio for new income opportunities. Does that refer to the current property portfolio and the possibility of debt-related opportunities?
Through the chair, yes, we've got $500 million worth of property assets across the CBD, range of classes of assets. We're doing that strategic property review work. So that could involve some divestment of non-performing and potentially investment in other asset classes. So I think, like I said, Tom and the team are doing some very detailed work and drawing on some external expertise, which we've been walking you through in different steps. We'll be bringing your report back in 7th of April from memory, back into council. To go through some of those options around probably about the top 30 or so assets that we think are probably the primary areas of focus across our portfolio.
So if I'm to understand that, the strategic property review in April will be about selling assets, not necessarily to go to the bottom line because of our debt problem, but also in order to borrow more money to find income producing opportunities?
Through the chair, no, I wouldn't interpret it that way. I think we're looking at the levers that we have on our balance sheet. All of those things ultimately will be decisions for council.
Oh, I understand that. But when we're talking about leveraging property portfolio, we're not talking about borrowing money then. We're simply talking now about selling property in April.
No, I think we're talking about leveraging $500 million worth of property assets. So there's multiple ways you can leverage your balance sheet.
Okay. I must say I am confused now, but anyway, thank you.
Councillor Noel, could I just ask, can we just get through the rest of the presentation before we have further questions? I'm just conscious of time, noting that councillors have, for the most part, read this already. Could we please just have the highlights?
Thank you, through the chair. So the next slide refers to our rates. Just very quickly, important to understand there's three levers there, rate from the dollar, the uplift in valuations, and the growth in new developments. Long-term financial plan currently forecasts 3.3%. What we have here is a graph which reflects where there has been the valuation uplift has not been in line with CPI. So in other words, we haven't kept up with CPI, what the foregone revenue has been since we froze the rate on the dollar in 2013-14. In 2019-20, that equates to $3.5 million. And cumulatively, that equates to about $15 million. So next steps are, we obviously bring in and go through the budget in March, and then in April we will be going through obviously the balancing of the budget, and the key discussion point there is obviously around the rates and what you'd want to do there, recognising we need to identify our expenditure before we set our rates. The other thing I'll just briefly touch on is obviously there's been the legislation introduced, I think, early last year or late the year prior regarding rate capping. It's important to understand that that legislation that was presented at that stage effectively was based on capping the average rate that the ratepayer pays. So it's the average rate across the whole city. The scenario for the City of Adelaide is largely dependent, based on what was previously presented in that legislation, on what transpires in terms of our rates on a year-on-year basis. If we had significant growth in low-value apartments or property, and then what effectively happens is that the average rate paid across the city is low, and so we wouldn't be impacted by rate capping. On the flip side though, if we had a significant increase in valuations, or we had a property or a small number of properties which had an individual rate payer that had a significant value, then that would significantly increase the average rate, and that's where the rate capping legislation will come in to cap our rates. It's very difficult trying to predict looking forward. One, we're still waiting to see what the revised legislation will be. But then beyond that, as I said, it's largely dependent on what happens on a year-on-year basis in terms of the valuations and the growth in new developments. The next slide just refers to our operational efficiencies. Very quickly running through this, cumulatively over the last 4 years we've identified effectively $12 million worth of efficiencies. What the situation has been is that year on year we've actually had underlying pressures of 5 to 6%. That's come from a range of things, but because of the identification of the efficiencies throughout that period, we've been able to minimise the actual increase in the operational budget. This has been partly due to a reduction in the number of directors and the associate directors. We've had savings identified through the program reviews and service reviews. We've had efficiencies in our contract negotiations, and we've also had a very considered focus on reducing our reliance on consultants and contractors. So it's just to recognise that while there have been quite significant underlying pressures, that in recent time we've been able to hold those at minimum level, but there is a limit to how far we can continue to do that. And Claire might just like to give us an update in terms of where we're at with the next stages of the service plan and performance reviews.
Sure, thank you, Alex. So we've been sharing with council members quite detailed information in relation to the 93 services that council currently offers. The next stage is to bring that information back to you to help you prioritise which services you want us to do more of a deep dive into in terms of value for money and efficiency and effectiveness. So we're hoping to try and align that through this budget process, and our audit committee is also providing support and input into that piece of work. So that's running in parallel to this year's budget build.
Will that discussion about services and bang for buck be a public discussion or an in-confidence discussion?
I haven't turned my mind to that, Councillor. There's a couple of things to sort of be mindful of. A lot of our services are associated with staff and resources, and I'd want to be respectful of any conversation either in public or in private that could perhaps potentially impact our staff in terms of how they feel about the work they do. Once I've got some more concrete thinking through from the team around how we might do that, I will give
thought to the clear message from this council, which is you prefer to have as much as possible done in public, and obviously I'll be respectful of that. However, I do need to also be respectful of the staff employed here at the City of Adelaide.
Please continue. Again, I'll remind you of the time.
So this slide just talks to infrastructure considerations. I'll take it as read, but just to highlight that we need to have a clear focus in terms of our asset sustainability ratio, and that obviously requires a priority focus on renewals, unless there are opportunities for co-funding that come along. The next slide refers to our borrowings level. This is reflective of what was presented in the quarter two finance report. Effectively, just to reiterate, we do forecast a breach in our prudential limit later this next financial year, in the second half of 2020-21. But we will be considering that in further detail as part of the budget process.
So obviously we're really mindful that we're concurrently building a strategic plan with council members over the last few months. One of the things we were hoping to try and build into next year's budget is some capacity to enable council members to either initiate or develop new projects to showcase and bring to life some of these outcomes. We're doing some work internally, as I mentioned last week at the workshop on the strategic plan, to build a four-year delivery plan. We're taking a lot of the ideas that council members suggested to us over the last few months and using those as a starting point to develop some ideas in relation to what could be new and different if we are to bring to life the next strategic plan. We're also working closely internally with staff and each associate director to think about how you pivot or reorient what you currently do to enable new community outcomes. And we're using the concept of impact, cost and time, but obviously any changes to anything that we're currently doing would always come back to council for consideration. So we're really mindful of enabling council members to influence how the next 2 to 3 years look like. We need the strat plan landed to enable us to do that, and we need the delivery plan built along the way.
So, excellent. I'll open it up for feedback. Thank you, Robert.
That's more a question rather than feedback, if that's okay. And I'm not sure whether it's a question best directed at yourselves or the CEO. You alluded to staff reductions in terms of key positions. Are you able to provide a bit more information in terms of the number of staff positions that have been discontinued as a result of the efficiency dividend?
I'll take that on notice and we can provide a response to you.
And does the City of Adelaide, this is probably one more for you, Mark, does the City of Adelaide undertake any studies in terms of staff morale and so on? And has that demonstrated any impact in terms of these efficiencies on staff morale? I mean, I guess performance is one thing, but I'm just interested to know how people might be reacting in terms of if there have been reductions in staff or constraints placed upon them as a result of the efficiency dividends.
Through the chair. Interestingly, a lot of the savings have come at the top end, and I don't think anyone cries when top end is hurt, quite frankly. Where efficiencies have been sought at other levels of service, as an organisation, we've been very mindful of making sure we do that in a respectful way and through natural attrition. We tend not to sort of slice through at that level. In terms of what that means for staff morale, we do undertake culture surveys, we do undertake pulse checks. We do get regular feedback from our staff. If we have changed methodology of how we measure staff satisfaction here at the City of Adelaide. It's probably too early to tell if there's a correlation between any sort of changes to how we might structure ourselves or how we might be impacted in terms of reductions in services or changes in how we offer a service. I think it's too early to tell.
Thank you. And just by way of context for my question, I guess, and I've made this point before, I've worked for government agencies and so on before where they've had efficiency dividends in place. And sometimes it does have a knock-on effect in terms of, I take your point, Claire, about senior level positions being the ones that are targeted, but sometimes that can have a flow-on effect in my experience to the organisation in terms of putting staff under more pressure, trying to do more, more for less and so on. And so I guess in addition to the $15 million cost that the rate freeze has had over the last few years, I'd also suggest there's probably been an organisational cost as well in terms of an impact on staff, their pressures that they're facing at work, and then a flow on the level of service that's provided to the community too, because if you call something like a call centre, for instance, or whatever, and you're interacting with someone who's been put under more pressure, that can of course that's going to have a knock-on effect. So I guess I'm just trying to make the point that it's a case of sometimes robbing Peter to pay Paul, and that none of these things, whilst they appear to be savings, the cost is felt elsewhere, either by people who work for the organisation or people in the broader community. But I would be interested to get those exact figures.
Sorry, if I could just comment, Cheryl. In terms of impact via customer satisfaction, we haven't noticed any changes, and in fact, customer satisfaction levels in some areas are increasing, so I would just make that a comment.
Members? Councillor Noel and Councillor Martin.
And just a bit of commentary as we were working through the various streams of income, etc., and I keep noting that we keep talking about our ratepayers, and that it's always skewed to the thoughts around the residential ratepayers. And we should also remember that the majority of our rates do come from business and from landlords, etc. And we do have to be mindful that we keep a competitive edge for our city as best as we can, so that they're able to maintain, their activities in the city, which underpin the majority of those extracurricular activities and benefits that we provide. So I think it's really critical that we do, when we think of the ratepayer, I mean, the, most of the benefits are derived from the individuals that live here or the people that visit, where the business are the ones usually carrying the can. So I also then look at and say, well, yes, I agree wholeheartedly that we should look at other forms of incomes, etc., and how we can, intelligently work the property portfolios of where we, as we have done with the various, constructions that we're a party to. I think it's critical that we think of those sort of things. And I can appreciate too the underlying cost pressures, etc., on the administration. Obviously there's a no-win here, because you've got to try and do more with less, and I just see how can we do that. And there's only very few hard things in your organisation that you can actually play with, and it would be interesting to see what other levers you can to provide better service with the efficiencies of technology, etc., than what we have had. So I just it's very hard. I can appreciate that, but we have to play.
Councillor Martin.
I agree with that summation. That is, businesses do constitute the majority of our ratepayers in terms of the income. And yes, we need to be mindful of the impact of rates on businesses as well as on residents. And that is why we need to, rather than, as is suggested here, review the impacts of a zero increase in the rate in the dollar since 2014, we need to consider staying on course. And I'd encourage Councillor Moran, who moved that motion, contrary to what you may have heard, who moved that motion originally, to move it again in the next council meeting, so that we take that off the table and have a zero increase in the rate in the dollar, if not in the coming year, then I'd suggest to her for the balance of the term of this council, and encourage this council to maintain that compact that it had with the ratepayers for so many years. The second thing is, I keep noting summaries of the strategic plan coming forward with a question mark, and noting also that we are continuing to move away from carbon neutrality, and we are still talking in terms of a low carbon economy. That is not the aspiration. The aspiration is that we will have zero carbon emissions. Nothing less would be satisfactory to me.
Deputy CEO, was there something we need to clarify?
Yeah, so by the sign-off for these reports preceded the feedback from the workshop on the strategic plan. So what you're looking at is an old version, so apologies for that. I wasn't able to make those changes swiftly enough to publish it tonight. And in terms of the no change to the rate of the dollar, Tracy, can you confirm what we currently have built into our strategic plan on the back of feedback from previous council?
Through the chair, so currently through in our long-term financial plan, we've assumed no increase in the rate of the dollar. However, under the way the legislation is for setting budgets, we actually don't determine rates revenue until after the budget process has been completed. So we cannot mandate that we will follow a no increase in rate. It can be a principle that you are seeking, but actually through legislation we have to work out what our expenses are and then how we get the revenue to match.
I understand that, but I mean, as a principle, I'm suggesting that Councillor Moran may care to put that on the table. And there are two other things I've asked the administration to provide for us, and that is a breakdown of the operations expenses, that is our operations budget, for the last 6 years, showing the increase in percentage terms, and then measured against the CPI for the period. One other thing which has slipped my mind, but I'll send it to you by email in relation to financial information to assist us. Thank you.
So in terms of how you want that broken down, Councillor, at the moment that's currently across the 93 services. Is that how you wish to see it? It might be actually quite challenging for us to be able to go and backtrack to keep the information consistent. So we will need to take that on notice and see what's achievable.
Well, if you just use the same formula so that the comparison for each year is identical, that's important, yeah.
Absolutely, I understand that. What I'm saying is we're presenting information at a much more detailed level, which we have constructed against 93 services. And to try and take that back year by year might be quite challenging, so I need to look at that to see whether that's possible and isn't going to be too challenging, because obviously what's important is the year-on-year comparison. So
the year-on-year comparison is what I'm looking for, and if by including the current year in which you have that breakdown, it distorts the figures, just give me the previous year's the year-on-year increase.
And it won't just be you, it'll be everyone here, because we'll need to bring that through in March.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Members for feedback.
Last chance.
Why not? You know what? Can I thank Tracy and Alex for taking us through this process? I know that some members say that this is a dry process, but it is necessary and we do need to go through it. Can I thank you for taking us through? I know that some of us do need our hands to be taken and taken through this journey, so thank you for doing it. And doing a good job, too.
Thank you. Members, that concludes our meeting this evening.